Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Jim Cornette Experience for today. The show that I tried to get out of doing and was talked out of it and into doing it, even though it's a day late, so we apologize. Not because I don't want to talk about this person, but because I don't want to talk about it in this context. And to join me in doing this, my co-host, the great Brian Last, who is the aforesaid individual who talked me into doing this program.
Aloha, Jim. Pleasure to be here once again. I know it's not the easiest week to do a show, considering the circumstances, but I think a lot of people will be happy to hear from you today.
Well, and that's... I'm going to be honest. What I did was I called you, a couple days ago. I said, all right. I said, can we run a rerun? No. And I thought you were going to hit me with the sponsor commitments, which we do have, because I had already planned to say, well, we can do makeups next week. Everybody's entitled to a week off every now and then. But then you hit me with the listeners and the people are going to want to hear what you have to say, which made me feel rotten. So, folks, if you don't know what we're talking about by now, but I'm... would imagine you do because it got so much publicity, and we'll talk about why and et cetera. But Tracy Smothers passed away a couple days ago. We had known since late last year that he was sick. He'd had cancer. He got treatments. I saw him last December at the event that they held in Knoxville for Bobby Eaton. That is, as a matter of fact, that's the last public appearance I've made. And he had been at WrestleCade in Winston-Salem about a couple weeks before that, and people saw that he was not looking well, and that's when he came out and told everybody. But he had had the issues with cancer at that point, and it had treatments, and that had, you know, gotten better at some point, but it returned. And also, besides the fact that Tracy's body had just been beaten up over the years ridiculously in wrestling, apparently he'd had a heart attack at some point and did not know it, and they found damage later on, so he only had like half of his heart function, and had also, in addition to undergoing the cancer treatments again, had a hernia somehow, and they were trying to figure out how to do surgery on that and treat that around the other stuff. And so anyway, I didn't know it had gotten this bad this quick again until I think about a week or so ago. And we had just, Brian, you and I had talked about it. There was a GoFundMe that had been set up, and we just heard about it and we're checking to make sure everything was good. And we're going to mention that, and did not have the opportunity. I would assume Tracy didn't have insurance, or obviously not being able to work. Even if he had any kind of insurance, I don't want to speak improperly, but you know, here's the thing is, I'm going to be all over the page because, as Brian knows, I have not prepared anything to talk about, because that would have required thinking about this whole thing. And it's a little much these days with this happening so often. But I don't usually plug GoFundMes, not only because, you know, if you do it every body in the world says, oh, with my friend or my child or whatever, you know, then you would just be plugging nothing but GoFundMes in our position. But in the wrestling industry, a lot of times you don't know. And I think one of the girls one time ran a GoFundMe for somebody said for cosmetic surgery, but you know, or it's somebody that's made big money and honestly blown it, or whatever the case. But in this case, Tracy, unfortunately, he made good money and money in wrestling for a long period of time, but he never made big money. And it wasn't because of a shortcoming on his part, but because of the way the business changed right when he got in it, which we'll talk about. So anyway, I think, and later on, and Brian, I know you were going to look it up, but I think that that fund has been turned into something for, you know, funeral expenses or whatever, and you can bring that up here in a little while. But the thing about Tracy is he came along, he was the perfect guy that came along at the wrong time. And even though he had reinvented himself over the last, gosh, longer probably than his run in the territories and in the big leagues, as they say, as a heel, and because he was so fucking entertaining, and as a person, and he just went with it because that was, you know, wrestling's what he did. And to stay in it, he did those things, but he was the quintessential hometown babyface. And hometown, you say, in one town, well, it could have been any town. Here's the thing. The concept in wrestling is as old as it's older than pro wrestling. It's as old as wrestling. The concept in anything of a hometown hero or a local boy made good, or he's one of us. That's what, in large part, pro wrestling operated on for the first 100 years it was around. Whether it was the local college football star or the local boy, but it's not just wrestling, politics, any kind of sports, anything. One of us made good. And Brian, think of how many territories, and even before the days of the formation of the territories, just big gates and crowds in the wrestling industry revolved around some way or another manipulating a local guy or a transplanted local that he may have been born in Oklahoma, but folks, he played football here in Florida or whatever, has made good in wrestling. Gus Sonnenberg, you know, in the fucking 20s. And Tracy was perfect for, the one thing I did start thinking about was if Tracy had come along exactly as he was in Smoky Mountain Wrestling 20 years earlier, or if the territories had gone on existing in the ways that they did 20 years later, Tracy Smothers as a main event level babyface with his level of work and his hard work in the ring, nobody ever worked any harder anywhere at anything practically than Tracy Smothers, and his promo at his size, the whole nine yards, it just because he was from Tennessee, the wild-eyed Southern boy, he could have been figured in the Florida territory, in the Georgia territory, in the Carolinas. He could have hung with those guys. It would have worked in Texas, definitely Mid-South wrestling, as well as the Memphis territory and Smoky Mountain wrestling. Those kind of baby faces, you always had your flamboyant, over-the-top, crazy gimmick baby faces. Mad Dog Vachon was a baby face at points in his career, especially when he became a legend. Handsome Jimmy Valiant was crazy. But the guy that territories like that wanted to build on as their white meat baby face, the fucking, the hero to the girls, the guys that looked up to him, you know, the Magnum TAs, the Barry Windhams, the whatever the fuck, you wanted them to be believable in the territories. You wanted them to be Eddie Marlin, for fuck's sake, in Tennessee. We talked about him when he passed away last year and how he got over as a main event guy in his 40s in the territory and drew huge houses because he was one of the people that were going to buy a ticket to see him. That was a bonus for a babyface in those days, in the Southern territories especially. You wanted people to identify with this guy. You wanted people to believe that he was really who he was supposed to be and that he meant the things that he was saying. And he worked like that. And the idea of that kind of babyface is not that he was doing all the crazy wild moves, but that he was going to take an ass kicking, bleed and fight and be screwed around and put upon and cheated out of shit, but never stop and finally win the thing, whatever the thing was. And for that, it required the business where people believed, or at least would believe if you gave them something that didn't slap them in the face with it, because they wanted to believe. And when they got behind those guys, then that they not only got over, but they stayed over in especially in these territories that were weekly territories or biweekly, and they saw them so many times and they rose and fell with them. And Tracy was really one of the last gasps of that. He was perfect for that in Smoky Mountain. And we talked about when we've done some of the deep dives. And if I don't tell all the stories today, go to YouTube, because I'm sure there's some on there. When we've done the deep dives on Smoky Mountain Wrestling, the Bluegrass Brawl, the Night of the Legends, whatever. Tracy was the perfect guy that I lucked into to fill that spot that hadn't been seen as a single on a national level and been, you know, beat to death, that connected with the people that filled that spot that almost nobody else could. Originally, I wanted Brad Armstrong. And finally, I got Brad late in the Smoky Mountain run, but I think it was better that way because Tracy was newer and fresher. Even though Brad had been over in that territory before, like we talked about, Tracy, they knew him, but he'd never been featured to that extent in Continental. But he made the thing because he worked his ass off. So I think that's, when you look at all the places that would have used a guy like Tracy, you would have used Tracy, period, in all those different territories had he not been unfortunately born too late and didn't get into business till, you know, somebody said 83, and I think he may have done a couple of outlaw shows in 83, but it was 85 in Tennessee when he got a chance to, he trained some with Tojo. Stan and Steve took him under their wing early, and Stan had known him. And, you know, he got a chance to work Memphis, and I think they went to Florida, and then territories are gone. You know, and then by the time that they got pigeonholed as the tag team, the Southern Boys were a fabulous tag team, but then they had to be the Young Pistols because there was more people in Wyoming than there was in fucking the South. I don't know. And they just got flip-flopped around on the national TV. He really didn't get a chance to do what he was capable of until he got the run in Smoky Mountain. I've rambled on. Where am I going with this?
You know, that's one of my favorite things, actually, about his arrival in Smoky Mountain. You did this really good interview with him because it wasn't polished. It just seemed natural. It seemed real. Where he was, like, on the porch of his house explaining about his Young Pistols run. I have nothing against Cheyenne, Wyoming, but I've never been there.
Yeah.
I don't know anything about it. I'm actually just a Southern boy.
Well, that's what I told him. I said, just sit down and without saying that the wrestling business is fake, just say to him, you're tired of other people telling you who to be. And telling people who you are, and that's not who you are, and it's obvious to everybody. And that's why you're here, because you've come home to prove what you can do. And that's what we got, and everybody can identify with that, right? And then we took him out and had him drive the boat around. We borrowed a boat from somebody, and just walking around in the woods and shit country people do, right? For fuck's sake, because he's from Springfield, Tennessee. And we used the Skynyrd song. All I can do is write about it, right? And it was a chance for him to be him. And also, obviously, self-serving on my part, I needed a top babyface that people would be interested in. But you know, so you can let him, you know, do that all you want on TV, but then he has to get in the ring and get it over. And he had a very unorthodox style, but it worked for Tracy, and it was so different that it made him stand out. And when he was fighting, you felt like he was fighting because he was in fucking motion and he had fire. And when he sold, he was down on his hands and knees and crawling around and fucking shaking his head, and you felt like he's fucked up. And even though he was, what, 6'2", 6'3", and 235 in those days, he could do the fucking flying elbow jawjacker off the top as his finish, you know, and come off with the double axe handle or whatever and drop kick and shit and do the flying kicks. But he wasn't out there doing goddamn gymnastics routines. It was in part of his offense when he was beating up a bigger guy. But yeah, that with the video, and that's just how we, you know, presented him. And he got his Southern boy stuff out of the fucking closet, and it was he was the wild-eyed Southern boy. Because the Southern boys, him and Steve, I'd been keeping an eye on him anyway. Because obviously, you know, if they had gotten loose from their contract, I wanted them. And as a tag team, because that's how I saw him originally, right? And that was the point where Steve got the brief run in New York. As soon as they got out of their WCW contracts, Steve had got the call, and I don't know how that got hooked up, but he was going to be a singing cowboy, right?
Lance Cassidy.
Yes. God damn it. But anyway, and he went, and, you know, he had to go and try, right? Because that was a lot more money he was going to make, you know, working Smoky Mountain Wrestling. But that's when, I guess, he was up there for a few months or whatever it was. And the Armstrongs didn't like to be away from home for a long period of time. And this was one of those deals where they were on the road for like fucking 2 or 3 weeks straight. And Steve's told me himself later on, he said, I got up in a hotel room somewhere and looked in the mirror, and the mirror cracked. And he fucking called the office, said I quit, and flew back home. But I'd already started Tracy, so that's why I brought Steve in with Scott. Anyway, so I, you know, at that was the point where, and I've said this before, Brian Lee was not a great top babyface. He was much better heel, but he's who I'd started with because that's who was available. And when it came time, I was able to transition Brian over to being a heel, where he excelled better by being able to bring Tracy in as a single. And that's why I said, all right, I've got one Southern boy, but Tracy's a great babyface. And now that the Southern boy team is going to be broken up, well, then we will do this. And that's how that happened. And like I said, with the video and on the porch and the whole nine yards, and you know, and just the music, man, it wasn't like some goddamn, you know, revolutionary fucking music video or whatever. It just gave you the flavor of Tracy.
You know, you talk about the Southern Boys, and I know we did the watch along just recently with the Midnight Express and the Southern Boys at Great American Bash 90. And in a lot of ways, that's the match that put them on the map nationally. That's the match that, in a lot of ways, legitimized them to the smart fans, let's say. Because that ended up finishing, I think, third in the match of the year rankings in the Observer, and it wasn't.
By the way, the first two matches were in Japan, so
yeah, it was the top ranked American match, and that was a year with a lot of big matches, but none excited people the way that match did. And to me, that's one of the sad things, is just the program that could have been with the Southern Boys and the Midnight Express.
Well, but here's the thing. That was the first ever grudge match in wrestling where the guys had a grudge against the office. And, you know, and especially when we did the watch along, and y'all can find that out there also. But when we did the watch along, I explained that, you know, they wanted the Ole decided, okay, for the only time that year, I think the Midnight Express, no, the second time in a year, the Midnight Express is going to actually win a pay-per-view match, but he didn't want any manager interference or use the racket or whatever. So we knew that we needed to gear it up a notch in the actual match. Those guys were great to work with. Like I said, the Stan and Tracy with the karate spot, because they had worked with each other and you know, Stan helped train him in Tennessee, and you know, Steve was such a great flyer and all the stuff Bobby could do. And then we false finished him to death. We either had, was it four or five false finishes? in that match, which for a tag team match was off the charts back then, because you didn't, I don't want to get off on a tangent into wrestling psychology, but if you go back and watch the classic tag matches, you didn't have a million false finishes, because even though you had a lot of false finishes in a world title match with Flair and Steamboat, whatever, the backslides, small packages, near falls, whatever, it's harder to change the momentum and go back and forth in a tag team match, because you're turning two guys' momentum and or four guys instead of two. So that's why sometimes if tag matches go into too many false finishes back and forth, you lose the plot. But in this case, one went fed into the other, and that's what had the people on the edge of their seats. So the finish, even the heels won. Holy shit, it's Baltimore. It's up north. They like the heels anyway. But the Southern boys got over with them because it was a great fucking match, and they got some respect from the people. But that's because they were using neither, you know, they weren't really using either one, either team, and they had something to prove. And they, you know, we all decided to buckle in and see if we could come up with something. And that's the thing. Tracy always Tracy worked too hard at every, to where I actually a couple of times on Smoky Mountain spot shows, if I knew he was sore or had a tough match in Knoxville or the day after one of those chain matches or whatever, I was at Tracy, you can just ease up. Oh, I want to blah, blah, blah. Or if somebody wasn't there, I can work twice. And you, as far as being a dedicated employee or somebody that want to make sure people got their money's worth or take care of the wrestling business or just do the right thing or whatever, you wanted 20 of those people. 20 people like Tracy in the locker room, if you could.
You know, and by the time he got to Smoky Mountain, he was still fairly young, and he had already worked for Memphis. He had a run in the UWF. I mean, he was an undercard guy doing jobs on TV, but he had worked for Watts. He had worked in Continental. He had worked in WCW. I mean,
even Florida.
Florida. Even though the territories were dying out, he had worked a number of places before he even got to Smoky Mountain.
Well, yeah, that period, like I said, in 85, from Tennessee, he was able to go, you know, the last days of the UWF, and then he and Steve as a team in Florida. Eddie Graham was already gone, and they were about to be bought by, then they did get bought by Crockett. That's where we first worked with him in 87. We went down to do one of the Florida TV tapings. And that's where, from that point on, you know, I knew that. Well, I didn't know in 1987 I was going to start a fucking territory, but I noticed people like that when we work with them. And so they were always on the radar when I actually did start thinking about talent, because they were a good team then. And it's just that then, you know, finally, by the time they got the WCW was falling apart by the time they got the chance to work there. And they also are another team that fell victim to the rotating bookers and rotating philosophies, and you know, 3 months with this creative team, and then Dusty moved him to Wyoming, and Dusty, he did that as a rib, because not as a rib on them, but it when they went and told, they actually said the Southern boys are they didn't want the Southern boys on WCW because WCW had the reputation as Southern wrestling. That was the only thing keeping people watching them at that point, was they had the reputation of Southern wrestling. And I think Dusty knew it was ridiculous. He said, well, let's make them cowboys, because Dusty liked cowboys, because it was fucking stupid. Anyway, I digress. Where was I? I don't even know where I was.
Well, one thing, you know, I've never talked to you about is while he was working for Smoky Mountain, he did several Japanese tours. And he did a lot of the garbage stuff. Like, I remember Tracy sending me a tape. He goes, here's me in Japan. And I didn't realize it was him. It was him as Jason the Terrible for Wing.
Yeah.
But he also wrestled for All Japan, which is obviously a very physical style. What do you remember about while he was in the midst of being the top babyface for Smoky Mountain Wrestling, him going to Japan?
Well, see, that's... I actually read that somewhere. I'm trying to remember. Somebody asked on Twitter or whatever. I've tried to stay off mostly the internet the past couple of days. But there was never any issue because I think he had a trip or two for Baba. I remember him going over and doing the independent stuff. What was that, FMW?
It was Wing,
which was another, yeah.
It was like worse than FMW. It was FMW if FMW didn't have standards.
Well, yeah, there you go. The point is, that was like, those trips were like, I think, a week or whatever. If, you know, he timed it out. I never remember Tracy missing Knoxville or Johnson City or whatever. You know, I worked with Candido on some dates, too, and worked with some of the other guys on some dates. You know, it just depended on, but they always had them in advance in those days. But it wasn't like he was going back and forth constantly, the disrupted programs. You know, especially the independent thing he did over there, I think that they'd go over for like a week or whatever. So I just leave him off of Hayside, Virginia spot shows at the end of the month. It wouldn't be the big show. So that was never an issue. Not that I ever remember. I never remember having an issue with it. How about that?
What about him coming back from working that style for 2 weeks in All Japan, let's say?
Well, no, because he wasn't. We used to have to fucking get to Bobby and Jackie Fulton to calm the fuck down. Because when they'd come back, because they were going over there for Baba, and they'd go over for a month and for All Japan, and they'd be used to fighting for their lives, and they'd come back, and Tom Pritchard and Stan Lane at the time when we first started, and Tom and Stan were partners, but said, Jesus Christ, they just got back from Japan, and we're going to get beat up for a week. But Tracy could slip right. He knew the difference. I mean, Tracy could throw some live rounds just because he was so physical and so into it. But it wasn't like there was a noticeable difference where you had to remind him to work like Tracy.
You know, when you bring up Tom Pritchard, I got to see a lot of Smoky Mountain Wrestling shows live. I got to see him in front of the biggest houses you ever drew. And of course, in front of some small spot shows. And I saw every TV show. I've seen so many of the house shows, either camcorder footage or stuff you released. Those are the two guys, Tom Pritchard and Tracy Smothers. When I think of Smoky Mountain Wrestling, there was no one who worked harder every single day. There was never a bad match. There was never like, oh, these guys are phoning it in. Tracy Smothers and Tom Pritchard, to me, whenever I think of Smoky Mountain Wrestling, those are the first two in-ring workers I think of.
Yeah, and that's why, as a matter of fact, they had the grapple in the gravel, as Tom called it. Oh, God. They used to come over, the guys that lived when we first started. And actually, some of the guys never moved from Nashville. And Tracy had a house in Springfield, so he lived there. But they would it's the other end of the state. They'd come over for the weekend shows, right? And Tom eventually moved over there. And Tony Anthony had been living in Nashville when he was working in Memphis, but he was from Knoxville. But anyway, some of the guys would ride back and forth. And I guess Tom had been winding Tracy up one day about whatever. And Tracy, the one thing, bless him, about Tracy is even back then, he used to joke in Smoky Mountain about having probably 10 or 12 concussions. And, you know, and back then, well, we're laughing too, because, and now it explains some things about various people, but we didn't know what we knew then. But we did know that Tracy would sometimes get ticked off and go from 0 to 60 instantly. So somewhere or another, Tom had been ribbing Tracy. And then, of course, in the buildings most of the time, I think we were up in Eastern Kentucky, the locker rooms are separate. So they may have, you know, ridden over to the Knoxville Inn together, but they're not just together constantly. So now I guess Ricky Morton took the opportunity to wind Tracy up about what Tom had said. And by the time they got in the ring for the Battle Royal that night, Tracy went for Tom. And what the fuck you got, blah, 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 and there's cousin, and there's what, and people are trying to get in between them. And so cooler heads prevailed, but Tracy's like, I'll see you later. And then they actually pulled over on the side of the road, because now Doc's fired up. Like, what the fuck? What the fuck's with this guy? And all was great the next day. They settled everything the next day. That's why I'm telling this story. It's not like there's been any lingering heat, because now it's one of those funny stories. But they're coming back from the town. Whoever Tom's riding the car with now, is fucking going down the road, and there's fucking Tracy, and Tom says, pull over, and Tom pulls over, and Tracy's car pulls over, and they get out, and they lock up. And that's when Tom realized, because there was a little promo first, but then when they locked up, Tom realized, well, shit, he doesn't really want to fight, neither do I, because they locked up. Actual collar and elbow on the side of the road in the gravel in the middle of Eastern Kentucky. And right as they're doing this and they're bulling back around a little bit and they're thinking better of it because it's the boys, right? But right then a fucking blue light pulls in behind them. It's the fucking cops. And here's these two guys and the people that are riding in the car with them. So there's probably like six guys pulled over on the side of the road. Two of them are scuffling in the gravel. There's obviously beer is contained in both of these cars in some fashion. And the cop's like, what the fuck? And Tracy says, I got this. He says, officer, we wrestled up the road in Cumberland with his accent, right? Because then automatically, the cop knows at least this is fucking local people here. We wrestled up the road. We're just trying out some moves. Don't do it in my fucking town. Get the fuck out of here and let them go. And they all drove down the road. And then Doc calls me at night. Well, me and Tracy just had a fight in the gravel. What? And we did interviews or whatever the next day. And they came early and talked about it. But,
you know, you brought up before how Tracy could have been in the territory days, a babyface anywhere he went. But I think the big revelation was in 95. When I started seeing the videos, and then, of course, I was in Louisville when the fans started a riot and trying to get at us, the fans, that Tracy was a fantastic heel.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of people talk about it, you know, in ECW, he started doing that dance. He started doing that in USWA as a heel because we were popping for, like, what is he doing? He would just start doing, like, I don't know how to explain it. He put his arms out and just shake his hips.
He was humping the people. That's what he was doing. He was like, fuck you, without actually saying fuck you, when you couldn't say fuck you back then. He was humping people. It was just an open-armed hump.
But it was great. Right? He did great promos. He was really, I was so surprised, because you think of him as being the epitome of a babyface, but he was fantastic as a heel. I wish he would have done more of that. I wish he would have had more opportunities. I wish there were territories he could have, but great heel when he had a chance.
Well, and see, that's the thing, is I've went on and on, as you mentioned, about how great a babyface he was. And that's something that I couldn't, if I'd have turned him in Knoxville and he'd have done the same stuff, I think it would have got the wrong kind of heat, because he was so good at making them like him and them kind of believing it, that it would have been one of those, we don't want to see that kind of heel turns. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong, but the reason why it was perfect at the other, because when the USWA versus Smoky Mountain thing on the other end of the state took off in Memphis, he was an outsider. He was from the other group that was trying to say that the USWA and its fans were all, he wasn't trying to say it, he was saying it, we're all shit. And they were better and blah, blah, blah. And then it fucking worked, because then he's the asshole redneck that everybody knows lives down the street and fucking hates. And a big mouth asshole. But yeah, it was. And see, that was the thing when the fucking police escort had to get the, and our Fan Week fans from Smoky Mountain out of the Louisville Gardens. People said, why didn't the Smoky Mountain USWA angle work better or get more attention? I didn't go with it fully in the Knoxville end or whatever. To be honest, besides the fact that we were monthly and Randy Hales and the Memphis territory, they had the luxury. It may not have felt like a luxury at the time, but they had the luxury of running weekly. And they could build things, and they still had the deals with the buildings that, you know, were beneficial to them. And they still had that Memphis TV, and Louisville TV was pretty strong too. So the problem was the talent situation was such that I had more of the guys that were over in their territory than they did at the time. Remember, except for PG-13, who I did use, because they were a fucking good little heel team. They were baby faces in Memphis. Their champion was Billy Jack. Remember Billy Jack Haynes, remember?
Yeah, he was great.
Well, but I didn't have time to, nobody in Knoxville knew who the fuck Billy Jack Haynes was, and I didn't have time because I only had a show once a month. I couldn't program them unless I had them come in and take over my TV and then build the cards around them. And to be honest, Billy Jack didn't do it for me at that point in time. Did you really? Were you into him like crazy?
I was watching the USWA TV at that time because it was really good. It was really the last great period of USWA TV because you had Brandon Baxter, who was really good as a heel manager. You had Tracy as a heel. Brian Hildebrand, referee Mark Curtis, finally got to be a heel on Memphis TV, and he was great as the heel referee from Smoky Mountain. And Billy Jack Haynes was fantastic as a psychotic heel. Little did we know how close to home that was.
Typecasting, possibly.
But he was great. There was so much really good stuff happening on USWA TV in 95, and so much of it was centered around the Smoky Mountain guys.
Yeah.
My favorite thing about the Team Smoky Mountain, who was on Team Smoky Mountain? Tracy Smothers, referee Mark Curtis, obviously you whenever you'd be able to make a date. You had Terry Gordy appearing with them. You had Robert Gibson as a heel.
Tommy Rich.
And then Pat Tanaka.
He hopped in the car when they were buzzing through Nashville halfway to Memphis. And the bodies worked some also, especially when they came down from when they got finished with their run in the WWF, they came down and would work weekends in Smoky Mountain and then Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Memphis, Louisville, Evansville or I don't think they were running Evansville at that point, maybe West Tennessee, whatever, in Memphis. They were splitting their time. And see, that was the thing. And we'll do a deep dive into the USWA SMW feud later on, but that was the thing. And I did bring Lawler over a few times because he transitioned the Smoky Mountain title between White Boy and Bobby Blaze for me. I guess with the Smoky Mountain USWA feud, like I said, it was a case of them being able to run the weekly towns and me only running the big towns once a month. And also I wanted to keep control because I didn't want to, get those guys too intricate in case somebody got tired of making that trip across the state. But that's where I was going with that is a lot of times people say, well, why didn't you use so-and-so or such-and-such or this guy or that guy in Smoky Mountain or at the time if they were in Memphis or whatever. A lot of times we knew what we were trying to do, which was run a territory. I didn't, even if I'd have had the opportunity to bring name star A in, if I felt that he's going to have no vested interest in really getting this thing over because he's just biding his time until he gets another, a deal with the national company or whatever, then I didn't want to get that started and just lose a guy. I wanted guys that had a home connection, that could afford to. I wasn't going to ask a guy that lived in Washington State to fucking start working 15 days a month in East Tennessee and Western Virginia for me because I wasn't going to fucking fly him every fucking week. And, so you got like in the territory days. Not only was, as I said, Tracy was from Tennessee, so was Tony Anthony, the Armstrongs. Lived in fucking Pensacola at the time, but they'd been driving that whole territory for years. So it was more about finding the outstanding talent that is already homesteaded here and that will come for an affordable fee and then find new young guys like the Candidos and the Glenn Jacobses and the fucking Al Snows or whatever that will come and work for the Bruiser Bedlams. It was a guy he came in because he wanted to see if he could make it in a territory. So that's what that was about. And for the, I guess when you think about it, to work 15 days a month, Tracy was making just under $2,000 guaranteed from me in Smoky Mountain. What would that be? That was in 1994. What would that be today?
Oh, I'm not sure. You're usually better with the calculations.
Well, that's because I have the keyboard in front of me and type the thing up. But it would be more like four-ish, because it's doubled at least. Plus, the baby faces were able to sell gimmicks, as the Rock and Roll Express will attest to. And Tracy was great with gimmicks, the Confederate flags on a stick and the pictures, and he was personable with people. But he actually, whoever he was working a program with, the heel that he was working a program with, whether it be Tony Anthony or whoever, Brian Lee sometime, he kicked them back a percentage of his gimmick sales, his merchandise. Because heels didn't sell anything. Because if you're a heel, nobody would want to buy that shit now, would they? And the heel couldn't go out in the fucking arena and sign autographs, because then not only would he not be a heel, if he was a heel worth anything, people be trying to fucking attack him. So Tracy's, well, because of the matches that we're having and this guy's helping get me over, he kicked his program opponent. I mean, not everybody every night, but he kicked his program opponents back some of his merchandise. But the point is, a guy in wrestling at that point, if he can work 15 days a month in his home area and make the equivalent, counting gimmicks, of what is today, you know, would be $6,000 a month. How many guys in the wrestling business would take that? Oh, let's say we'll give you $75,000 a year, work 15 times a month in the wrestling business, and though you don't have to fucking fly. So that was, you know, that was why we put together guys that knew how to do Southern wrestling, that had a vested interest in wanting to see the wrestling business and the wrestling business in that area succeed. And Tracy worked harder than anybody at it.
You bring up his gimmick table. He also would just give people gimmicks if he thought they would want it.
And yeah. Like
it. He used to give me stuff at Fan Week that I would take home. And I can't believe I did this looking back now. But there was a while where I would go to school on Long Island in Long Beach wearing a hat that said American by birth, Southern by the grace of God. Because yeah. He gave it to me and I would wear it.
And I mean, he'd give kids stuff to here you go. Here you go. What's your deal? Here you go.
What's your deal?
What's your deal? And here you go. And he'd give the kid the picture.
He
right?
was the first person I ever heard say that. He would always say that to me whenever we would talk on the phone. Hey, Brian, what's your deal? And it took me a while to understand how to answer that. But that's just what he says.
What's your deal? What you up to? How's it been?
You know what one of his other favorite expressions? Whenever Tracy would get angry about someone or something, and we'd talk about what he would do to that person, he would say, I'll knock his dick stiff.
Yeah.
Which not many people can get away with an expression like that, but he would say that often.
Well, I'm taking up for Tracy, but I would do that all day long, but that's not a new expression, Brian. You just live up north.
That's right.
People been having their dicks knocked stiff for long before me or Tracy, either one, were born. But then the old fucking deal, right? And the guys did this when I got in the business, right, in the locker room. They would come up with the same, not exactly the same verbiage, but the same flavor. They'd say the same kind of thing, but Tracy had the best delivery. When people be going, oh, goddamn, that show is a shit. It didn't draw. The house was rotten. And people be going, well, you know, school's just got out, or school's just gone back in, or weather just got warm, or the weather just got cold, or daylight savings time, or whatever. And it was always some fucking excuse. And then Bobby Eaton used to say, and there's an all-night gas station open down the street, right? Tracy would time in with, well, you know, McDonald's open. Can't compete with that. And it just... Oh, God damn it. Anyway.
The WWF run as Freddie Joe Floyd. Let's talk a little bit about that.
Well, I apologized to him a couple of times profusely. And, of course, it ain't you. It ain't you. I think we've mentioned this on the show, but the idea was, at that point in 1996, the talent roster, the complete talent roster in the WWF, was short and not scintillating. It was one of the smaller ones I think they've ever had. And with me and Bruce Pritchard trying to make matches for television and at the same time not give away what you were selling in the arenas, that was a thing they still try to do in those days. You know, we got nothing. We got no combinations, because there's hardly, and I had the idea, why don't we find people around the country that are not under contract to WCW? and put them under contract to us for television appearances. They can still wrestle other places they want to, but that we can bring them to TV. We give them wins to get them over. And then we use them to put our top guys over. So it's just like bringing a guy into the territory. You just don't have to book him on the house shows, because on the house shows, they were only running one show a night. I think at that point there was plenty of talent there, but we just needed more for TV. And of course, then we said, well, go find these people. So we go for good workers that you can use in a variety of situations. Bill Irwin was one. Tony Anthony and Tracy Smothers were two more. Goddamn Tom Brandy.
Alex Porteau.
Alex Porteau, the Pug. Poor Pug. You know, guys that you could easily, either they had a somewhat of a reputation, but you could easily put them over some guys, give them some TV wins, and then use them to put your stars over. And of course, they signed all those guys, immediately forgot about putting any of them over, and also immediately changed everybody's name, and we've made so much fun of this. Tony, because his father was a plumber, became T.L. Hopper. And Bill Irwin, because he played hockey one time because he was from Minnesota, became the Goon, and et cetera. Alex Porteau, who missed a heck of that guy was flawless as a worker and just needed to be able to develop more as a personality, but the territories went away. Because he was an amateur wrestler, he became the Pug. And it was, you know, it had the stench of grisly death on it before it ever even fucking started. And then those people never won any matches. So it just became bad gimmicks doing jobs. But Tracy, because he was Southern, and because I guess Vince and Bruce Pritchard wasn't about to fucking disagree with Vince on any of this and tell Vince anything about geography. Oklahoma is not part of the South. That's out west. But suddenly, Tracy became Freddie Joe Floyd because Jerry Briscoe's first name is Floyd and Jack's first name was Freddie Joe. And he became from Oklahoma. And he's like, oh, I just, you know, whatever the fuck. He wasn't mad at me, but I was embarrassed for everybody that was involved in that.
It was definitely a difficult time for him, though, because those guys weren't making a lot of money. And they were responsible for all their trans and their hotels. And I know he was surprised by all that. He stayed at my house when he wrestled at Madison Square Garden for the first time. We took the Long Island Railroad into Madison Square Garden.
That must have been fun with having Tracy on that thing.
That was a lot of fun because he was just, once we got to Queens, anyone from Long Island, I'm just saying this, once we got past Valley Street, he was looking out the window and he just kept asking, are there a lot of gangs here? Is this a big gang area? I mean, no, it's just, it's Queens. This is where they killed chickens. But he was already looking for, like, other options, because that was when he was trying to get into an arena football league. He was already thinking about
in
96.
Remember.
Yeah.
Well, no, as soon as they told him his name was Freddie Joe Floyd, he was starting to think of other options. You know, but anyway, but that's, and then, you know, I didn't watch a lot of the ECW stuff, but I was glad that Paulie used him. But, you know, once again, I wasn't a fan of him, you know, having to pretend to be Italian. I just saw Tracy in more prominent positions than what he was featured at in the rest of his TV run. But
he made the best of it, though. You gotta give him credit. Yeah. He made the best of it.
He did. Well, he made the best out of everything as much as he could. And I think that's why he got so much publicity. That's one of the things I said at the start of this. Why other guys who have been, let's face it, bigger stars in the business maybe longer ago, but bigger stars in the business didn't get nearly as much attention when they passed, because all the guys love Tracy. It wasn't a groundswell of the fans at first, but it was the boys in the business that found out about it first and spread the news, and then all the news sites and everything picked up on it. But everybody loved Tracy because everybody coming up over the last 20 years at one point or another has worked with him or worked around him or just been around him. And, you know, he's always trying to help everybody as far as advice and you know, do this or don't do that, or you know, not in the way I would, but in a friendly way, because that was just him, you know, because he wanted guys to get better. And I've seen him go out and work his ass off to try to have, to try for his opponent to have a good match that he probably had no business having, but he was having it with Tracy. So Tracy made a point of making sure he did, right? One of those type of deals. And then, you know, even the last couple times I've seen him, I've only seen him actually perform maybe a couple times in the last, I don't know how many years. Because I didn't do that many independent shows, but on the he worked, oh, God damn it. I think it wasn't Bobby Fulton's last time I saw Bobby Fulton have a match was for Gary Damron over at All-Star Wrestling in West Virginia when we had the Midnight reunion last year, and they put the Midnight in the Hall of Fame over there.
Oh, that's right, with Stephen New's daughters.
Yes, the Legends match on the card. I'm just thinking about this now. He had booked Bobby Fulton versus Tracy Smothers. And Bobby, this was before Bobby was diagnosed with his cancer, and I assume before Tracy also. But the point is, I said beforehand, I said, Bobby, you've been having, because Bobby had been having trouble with his eye. You know, he's lost some vision in one eye. And I said, they wanted me to go out and manage or do something. And I said, hey, I said, why don't we just have a little fun rather than anybody taking too many bumps here? And anyway, that's when Tracy came out doing his heel thing and doing the promo, and Bobby Fulton had just done his promo talking about how proud he was to be there and be recognized as a legend. And they had the portraits that Steve New's daughter had painted of him and all this stuff and everything and the big presentation. And then he said, you know, Bobby said, you know, I've lost a sight in one of my eyes, this one here, and I don't wrestle much anymore, but I'm looking forward to having a good, clean wrestling match with Tracy Smothers. And then Tracy comes out and he's doing the heel promo and he takes the picture of Bobby Fulton and poor Steve New's daughter as drawn, and he breaks it over his head. No, he said, which of your eyes is the bad one? And Bobby pointed to his right one, this right here, and he thumbed Bobby in his bad eye. Oh my God. And then he takes the portrait and he breaks it over Bobby's head. And he fucking shoves me out of the way, and he does what? And he's going to take Bobby's eye out. And I jumped up and shoved him, and Bobby Fulton did a schoolboy, and Steve New rolled in and counted 1, 2, 3, and the people went banana. But anyway, that may be the last job that Bobby Fulton has ever done, or that Tracy Smothers has ever done, come to think of it. He was noted for not wanting to do job. No. He would argue sometimes about, do you think we ought to put so-and-so over? No, Tracy, just hold on. But he was that way. So that's like I've said, all the guys have had a chance to work with him or to be around him. And he was fun. And he was one of those characters. I can use that word here. I hate the word character in wrestling, except when it's used like Mama Cornette used to use it. Not what character does he portray, but boy, that guy's a real character. That's the way you're supposed to use character. And Tracy was a character. And that's why everybody, you know, was so fond of him. So whether it be the independent guys, the guys in WWF, everybody's been around him at one point or another. And everybody had good things to say. And I guess, as a matter of fact, did you find that the information on the GoFundMe?
Yeah, I have the GoFundMe here. It's not really an easy to say address. So what we'll do is I tweeted it out the other day. I'll retweet it again when this show comes out. But what they're doing is it's now billed as Tracy Smothers Memorial Fund. They're trying to get together the money to afford the funeral service. And lots of people from professional wrestling have already donated. Lots of fans have already donated. So what we'll do is you could go to GoFundMe and search for Tracy Smothers Memorial Fund, or I'll make sure I tweet this out when the show comes out.
Okay, and I will retweet that and obviously send something and et cetera. But I don't know.
Which matches should fans seek out that never saw him at his peak, let's say? Some of the younger fans. I would think, obviously, the match with Dirty White Boy at Bluegrass Brawl.
Well, that's what I was going to say. I looked, and it's a... If you go to YouTube, besides, obviously, we talked about the Midnight and Southern Boys from the 1990 Great American Bash in Baltimore. Also, if you go to YouTube, Tracy Smothers versus Dirty White Boy, SMW, or Smoky Mountain Wrestling, or Chain Match, I looked at it, actually. It's not one of those... like fifth generation VHS dubs that you can barely, because there's a lot of ghosts and a lot of, you know, break up a picture. It's not that. It's just dark. It appears to be off the VHS, but the people that did that didn't do a great job of it. But that's a great match.
The story behind it's almost as good as the actual match, because obviously Dirty White Boy decided that he was from New York, started wearing a Yankee jersey. The wild-eyed Southern Boy, Tracy Smothers, is Mr. Southern Wrestling. And the
hold on, don't just jump ahead of it then. If you're gonna give the background, Dirty White Boy was managed by none other than Mr. Ron Wright, who was the all-time East Tennessee wrestling legend. And they decided that because the fans were on the side of the wild-eyed Southern Boy, that they were ashamed of the South, and instead they sold their property down there and moved to New York, and were officially introduced from New York, wore New York Yankees ball caps and jerseys, and committed the unpardonable sin of, in Jellicoe, Tennessee, by the way, and the high school was not apprised that this was going to take place ahead of time. They just thought we were doing some wrestling TV taping. They brought a big metal barrel in the middle of the ring, handcuffed Tracy to the ropes, and burned the Confederate flag in front of him while it was only feet, inches out of his reach to stop it. And that required getting even. And the only way the Dirty White Boy and that evil Ron Wright would allow Tracy to get even and fight for the Smoky Mountain Heavyweight Championship is if he fought Dirty White Boy in Ron Wright's specialty. The Tennessee chain match, left wrist to left wrist with a 10-foot steel chain, and everybody in that territory had grown up seeing Ron Wright peel the skin off people with that Tennessee chain and give them a good old-fashioned East Tennessee dog whooping. But Tracy Smothers was going to be different. And by gum, he was. Now, when you watch that match, bear in mind this was April 2nd. Right in eastern Kentucky, so it's not hot weather. But at the Hazard Memorial, it was the Memorial Gym at the old college gym there. Not Hazard. Let me say that again. Pikeville, the old Pikeville College Gym. And there was not only no air conditioning, but also they didn't think they'd need it. But once we got the TV lights in there, and once we oversold the building, it was 125 fucking degrees in that place. The walls were sweating. And they went out there and did a half hour carrying, and that was a real chain. It wasn't one of these goddamn, you know, plastic or aluminum deals that they've tried to get away with sometimes in modern times. It was a fucking chain, and they carried that thing for 30 minutes. And in the finish, when you watch that match, it was the old Tennessee chain match finish, and why would you do anything else? The heel wraps the chain around the babyface's neck and cranks him over his shoulder and walks around touching all four corners of the ring. But as he goes by, the babyface that's backwards and has that thing around his neck reaches his left hand out and touches the turnbuckle behind him. The heel ain't paying attention. Referee Mark Curtis is in there 1-1. 2-2, and then they were both bleeding. They were both sweating. It was 125 degrees, and now Tony has cinched up on that chain to the point that Tracy is being choked out. Tony plods by the third buckle, and Tracy misses it. Tony takes him back, and Tracy can't get it. And he fucking puts the brakes on. And he's like, God damn it. Okay. And Tony had to let him loose to punch him in the fucking head. Boom. And wrap him back up again where he could breathe and start the thing again. And they, this time they get 3-3. And Tracy puts the brakes on. And fucking Tony jerks him and he goes over the top of Tony, backwards rolling on his ass, boom, and touches the buckle, and the fucking babies flew in the air. Those people went insane. It, because it was two guys that had had a fucking struggle with a goddamn 25-pound fucking chain for half an hour in that oven, bleeding and sweating, and you got with it. And they finally, they got to see what they'd paid to see, which was Tracy Smothers get even. And of course, that's the night that they told the story. The Klan was there and came up and told Tracy.
That was what I was going to say. Tracy was at the gimmick table and some guy comes up to him and says, good luck tonight. If you don't get him, we will. And hands him a business card.
Yeah.
And it's, I don't know what his position was, but it's someone from the Ku Klux Klan. Tracy immediately went in the back and threw up.
He was the comptroller.
I don't know if he was the Grand Wizard or I don't know what
positions they had. I don't think they actually put the particular, you know, fucking details on the.
They don't put their job titles on their business card.
I'm pretty sure maybe, and not phone number or email also. But
hooded number one. But no, Tracy.
Ron was sitting on his fucking pistol in his wheelchair. Just in case. But and as the Tracy came back, he told us, but I'm like, well, don't worry, you're going over. And we didn't have any trouble. And that's another thing that Tracy mentioned a long time ago. And I will say this again, because especially in modern times, people have actually taken a clip from where Dixie Dynamite, Scott Armstrong did the Dixie Dynamite gimmick before Tracy came in as a wild-eyed Southern boy and hid Scott's mask and it was all the Confederate colors, Dixie Dynamite. Because it was a gimmick that he used to work in Pensacola and Continental with, which was in Dixie. And it was his match on TV against the Stormtrooper in Smoky Mountain Wrestling, who had the fucking Nazi Stormtrooper outfit. And people said, what was the thought behind booking the Stormtrooper? Well, he had the fucking suit. And that's his gimmick that he fucking did jobs in on TV. I needed a job guy. I said, hey, come on and do a job for me. But Tracy made the point that all the people that with the, he never meant any disrespect or any hate or any ill will toward anybody with the Confederate flag. It was his gimmick that he used because he was from the South and because when you grew up in the South, you saw the flag. You didn't see any backlash or hear any backlash to the flag in those days because it was everywhere. And once again, I'm not saying whether that's right or wrong. Of course, when you come down to it, it was the losing side in a battle of insurrection. However, at that point in time, the Confederate flag was what, when you went to Myrtle Beach, South Carolina on vacation, you bought something with a Confederate flag on it because everything sold there had a Confederate flag on it. What was on your cap, Brian Last, that said American by birth, Southern by the grace of God?
There was an American flag, and next to it was the rebel flag.
Confederate flag, yes. The
Confederate flag, yeah.
And as hard as it may be for some people who now just instantly go, well, how can you not realize that that's a symbol of oppression and the Nazis? The Nazis weren't using it in Knoxville because there wasn't any Nazis. Not at least that we ever saw or could find. The Klan used it, but everybody was used to them, and we didn't really cultivate their patronage or participation. But most people just had it out in front of their house or just because they got it on vacation. I got a fucking Confederate flag bandana autographed by members of Lynyrd Skynyrd 20-something years ago because they sold those at their concerts. And the point was, Tracy never meant anything bad by that. It was a symbol to them like it was a lot of people of just home. This is what we see when we go home. They're flying around everywhere because people have used it and co-opted it to endorse their shit. But for a lot of people, they didn't think that way. And Tracy's one of those people that didn't ever think that way. So I saw some guys was a couple years ago on, well, this guy, and then center, well, fuck, because that was his gimmick. And it was never attached in his mind as to anything bad otherwise than something that he flew because that was his gimmick and he was from home. I don't know any other way to phrase it.
You know, other matches I think that people should, if they could find it, definitely check out. Thugs versus Heavenly Bodies at the Super Bowl of Wrestling.
That was a good one.
That was fantastic. And of course, there was that whole backstory with Tracy and Ricky Morton, so you didn't know what exactly you were going to do. And it ended up being just one of the great matches I ever saw live. It's great on video, but live in the building, it was fantastic. And that's, of course, where Tracy pile drives Tom Pritchard right through the table. You could never redo that the exact same way ever again.
Okay, and here's the thing. Originally, the spot, and it's on tape, so you can see it. We had advertised the first big, it was the biggest show we'd ever done. The main event was Shawn Michaels and Buddy Landell for the Intercontinental title. The gate, I think, was like $4,000 or $5,000 bigger than Night of Legends the previous year. And we had advertised the first in the Rock and Roll Express versus Thugs, Tracy and Tony series, two babyface teams, what's going to happen. And we've told this story on other podcasts, but Tracy's and Ricky Morton's girls got in a fight and they're blah, blah, blah. So then it became Tracy and Tony, the Thugs versus the surprise return of the Heavenly Bodies from the WWF. And I wanted to make sure that we gave the people as good a match as possible and some wild shit and start some stuff and et cetera, because we were substituting one of the two main events already on the show. But we did, you know, at least we had the bodies, which, you know, made it a little bit more palatable, a substitution. And we're going to have a big fucking brawl. And I gave them the spot. I said to go, because we had to pay $88 for those tables in Knoxville when we broke them. And they must have bought like 7,000 tables at the Knoxville Civic Coliseum back in 1962, because they were all the same. They were those old particle board tables. They weren't like Formica, like the ones that break in half easily. They had metal, weird metal legs that folded out, and they were particle board tops and real rough. And I said, go ahead. I said, I think it was Tony was going to shoot Dr. Tom off while they were on the floor to Tracy, and Tracy was going to backdrop him, and Tom was going to go through the fucking table, which is how you use a table. It happens to be sitting there, and somebody falls through it rather than you set it up and you put it, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, well, when Tracy backdropped him, Doc didn't get in the right place, and he had to kind of do a handstand on the table, and he just kind of went over and boom, and it didn't break. And it was kind of like a popcorn fart. And I'm like, shit, as I go by, Tony's chasing me, whatever. I'm like, see if you can break it. And that's all I said. So a second later, I see Tracy getting Doc up for a pile driver. I'm like, holy shit. When he pile drove him, the table broke, but the table didn't break in half. For anybody that's never seen this clip, a hole broke underneath Tracy's ass, and they just went straight through. The table was still sitting up, perfectly upright, and they just went straight through it and through this round hole that Tracy's ass and Tom's head made, and got stuck. Tom upside down and Tracy folded up like a jackknife with his legs sticking out of one side and his fucking head sticking out of the other side. So then, and then the people liked that one, Brian. So that was the origination of that table breaking.
The other match I think of, or maybe series of matches would be a better way to say it, is Tracy and Chris Candido.
Yeah.
And of course they had those ladder matches, which, correct me if I'm wrong, I think the ladder matches they had were before the WrestleMania. Was it before the WrestleMania 10 ladder match with Shawn and Razor? I mean, it was around the same time.
Some of them were concurrent. Because, see, I'd seen Michaels and Razor do it on a house show out in California before WrestleMania. And I got the idea. I said, well, Tracy and Candido are the only two that can do this. So I asked them, and because they knew the concept because they'd done them, and they hadn't done them, but the ladder matches had been done in Calgary. So they all, you know, and I'm sure Candido had tapes to study. So they started doing them. It was because some were before and some were afterwards. And I think they did one on TV, and goddamn it, that's when we needed new ring posts. Because what we did, because we couldn't fly anything from these high school gym roofs, we'd had to rent a scissor lift and everything. So we'd put a pole up opposite ring posts. We'd tape a pole to them, and we would put the rope across the pole and hang the check from that. Well, we needed new ring posts on our ring, and as the more they took bumps and the ring posts were kind of bent anyway, the pole started slipping in, and then the fucking string was, the rope wasn't tight. It's hanging the check. So it got to the point where they could get up on like the third step of the ladder and get it if they were unmolested. But they, you know, once again, they did a great job with those, and they were so athletic, and, you know, again, Candido was strong as a bull. So they could make some, and we were just getting those fucking ladders at Home Depot. Also, it wasn't like these custom made jobs that they have in the WWF where you can climb from every side. And at one point the metal, leg broke on one of the ladders from being in the ring where the mat was squishy and everything. And poor Hildebrand had to get under it and become a human leg, which he almost had a third leg. Maybe it was just the fact that he was a smaller individual anyway, but Hildebrand was a, could have been the next John Holmes, but he made a third leg under the fucking ladder and held it up so that Tracy and Candida, here's, he's 5'6" and 145 pounds. He's holding up the ladder so that 450 pounds of wrestler can climb it. So any of those, anything of Tracy and Smoky Mountain that's on YouTube, I don't know what the Evil Empire may have yanked down. Obviously there's a lot of stuff from ECW, and I don't know of any of those to recommend offhand. And there's probably, you know, more of their, I didn't see a lot of their WCW stuff after we left, but he and Steve, you know, were there for a while, even as the Young Pistols. Tracy was still doing the best he could do under the bad gimmick circumstances. But anyway, yes, and we will retweet the GoFundMe information and everything, but I don't know what else to say, and you've got me through this. I appreciate it, Brian, but I don't know what to say that anybody else hadn't already said. You know, here was a guy that really, as we said, he wasn't one of those guys that made big money and then blew it and didn't, you know, he worked hard at everything he did, and just, you know, he should have gotten some better breaks to be more successful financially in this industry than what he was. And so anything that you might can donate is not going to reward or somebody that was just irresponsible and whatever, and expecting somebody else to take up for him. It's somebody that really deserves it and did deserve it. And, you know, I don't know what else to say.
As a wrestler, he was a great wrestler. And as a person, he was a great person. I mean, like you said, universally loved. You don't hear anyone say, you know, that goddamn Tracy Smothers. No, everyone loved him. And it was a multi-generational thing. The guys who came up with him, the guys that worked with him in the 80s or 90s, they loved him. And the next generation of wrestlers, the younger crop of guys that sat in a locker room with him. You know, I saw CM Punk tweeted out a bunch of stuff about how helpful Tracy was to him early in his career. There's a lot of guys that have that story. So he's someone who, people who worked with him during the prime of his career loved him, and then the next generation of guys who got to learn from him loved him.
He'd had his, as he used to say, I've had my bell rung. He's had his bell rung umpteen times, so he would sometimes just flip off and get pissed at something or somebody or whatever, and everybody seen him do the shadow boxing, not even shadow boxing, just punching lockers, because he'd work himself up about something, but then he'd be just as quick to apologize later on or whatever. And, you know, there's another clip on YouTube. I'll say this, we'll end on a high note. There's another clip on YouTube. One of the VHS tapes that we released in Smoky Mountain was the A Country Boy Can Survive, the best of Tracy Smothers. It had some of his matches on there. And also, I kept and put together some of the bloopers and the promo outtakes. Because Tracy would get so wound up. And I mean, one of them, he's doing his promo, and the black sheet that we taped up as a background, taped up to the wall, came down behind him, fell halfway down, but he never even stopped. And everybody's giggling, and he don't know why they're giggling, but he don't want to stop. And another time, it's like, and Brian Lee, let me tell you something, you no good, self-centered prick. And he goes, oops, you know, because you can't say that back then. You can now. But the best one was, this was when he and Tony were the thugs. So they had just done something in WCW. I can't remember what, but something on their TV that pissed him off. Because he had a bad experience, in, as we mentioned, in WCW anyway. And so it didn't take much. And they had done something. And he's doing a promo about Tony and him against the Heavenly Bodies, or I think it was going to be. But instead, he says, and you know, you got WCW, or he didn't even say WCW. He said, you know, you got people that have no respect for this business or the people in it. You got big fat Vader. And he started, what the fuck, and down there, and this guy and that guy, that no good Eric Bischoff. And they don't have any respect for wrestling and blah. And he got started on his promo, and he said, if you got any problem with what I have to say, I live it. 827 Hillside Drive in Springfield, Tennessee. It was his home address. and I'm dying laughing. I think we ended up airing it because he eventually got back around to who he was wrestling, but it made sense in the context of what he was talking about. But at the same time, he just got mad on the promo, working himself up, and cut a promo on fucking WCW and gave him his home address in case they needed to come see him. So, and that is out on YouTube also. Tracy Smothers bloopers or something, I think. Anyway. As I said, 45 minutes ago, I don't know what else to say, but I don't know what else to say. I'll miss Tracy. Nobody worked harder for me when I was running my company. I was a fan of his to watch him wrestle and as a personality, and we had a lot of fun just bullshitting. That's another thing. I don't know why all this shit happens to people. Tracy had beaten his body up, yes, but do bumps give you cancer? He didn't use tobacco. He didn't do the things one would normally. He didn't use steroids. If he did, they didn't work. So I don't know, you know, what else you're supposed to not do to not get all these horrible illnesses. All right, I got a perfect segue to bring our energy level and enthusiasm and general overall mood up a bit. Brian, let's talk about a guy that's maimed himself for life.
Wow. I don't know how that'll bring us up.
No, and I can't even knock this guy. An update on the grasshopper guy. This poor fuck. We talked about it, I think, on the last show we did. Whenever we did one last, seems like we do them all the time. But the clip went viral, as they say, of the guy jumping off the corner of a homemade ring and breaking both his legs in the most almost cartoon fashion, to where, as somebody said, I don't even remember saying this, but I didn't even know you could do this injury if you tried on purpose, is what he broke both of his legs bent backwards at the knee at the same time when he jumped off the ropes. Everybody's seen the clip. I can't bring myself. I don't have it in me, Brian, to knock this guy any more than we probably made a bit too much fun of him on the last program. But come to find out, there's a GoFundMe for him also. I'm not going to plug that because he still has to bear some responsibility for this. But I don't even know if this was a supposed outlaw mud show or if it was just friends getting together in the backyard. Because the way that it was written, it was like some friends of his asked him to participate in an amateur wrestling event. Now, of course, it wasn't amateur wrestling, but it definitely was amateur professional wrestling. And so I've got to, because honestly and truthfully, if this was just some friends, and of course they say don't try this at home, but if this was some friends playing out in the backyard amongst themselves and they didn't sell tickets to this or advertise it or say it was a professional wrestling show, then a bunch of us have done shit like that. And I got to be honest, when the guy jumped off the ropes, there was no reason to believe that this shit would happen to him. It's not like we have talked about in the past, some of these idiots who climb up on top of some gimmicked up contraption of Home Depot products and then dive into a pool of piranhas surrounded by broken glass or whatever. Well, yeah, you're getting what you fucking deserve, you miserable idiot. Slice all your goddamn nerves and arteries and all that shit and fucking incinerate yourself. I don't care. This guy jumped off the fucking ropes in a homemade ring where apparently they were pretending to be wrestlers. It was a calculated risk to jump off those ropes. You saw it. Could you believe that that could happen from that physical activity?
It did surprise me. You know, when it first went around and I pressed play, I didn't know what to expect. I certainly didn't expect that. I felt it in my knees. As soon as I saw it, I grabbed my knees and just clutched them a little bit.
Clutched them.
It was a bit surprising, yes.
So anyway, so apparently the guy, the GoFundMe's for like $200,000 or whatever. The guy has already had several surgeries, pins and rods. Amputation is apparently still on the table.
Holy shit. Really?
And all kinds of, no, this is not something that that medical science can just say, okay, we'll just fix this up for you. This is going to be a long process to get any semblance of anything back. So anyway, I'm not going to beat this guy up because he didn't really do anything stupid, but God almighty. So that's the update on when you can move your legs, grasshopper, it's time for you to leave. Are you taking any bets on whether he's going to do that again?
I'm pretty sure he's not going to do that again.
That's a pretty safe bet to take. I don't know if they're even taking that bet over at my bookie, but I tell you, they're taking every other bet in the world, whether it's the Patriots or the 49ers or the Bucks or the Raiders or whoever those teams are that I don't follow. If you want to bet on them, go to my bookie. They've got deposit matches, free bets, huge cash prize, contests all season long, NFL check, college ball check. They've got a mobile-friendly website. You can drive right up to it. Top-of-the-line customer service. Their platform is a one-stop shop for all your betting needs. MyBookie offers action on everything from championship futures to NFL in-game live betting. And congratulations, by the way, if you were the ones to cash in on the generous early season odds on the Lakers. I understand that they recently won the Joshi Princess title. Sign up at MyBookie today, folks. When you do, use our promo code JCE to claim a deposit match dollar for dollar all the way up to $1,000. You put in $100, they give you another $100. And then you got to be smart enough to go from there. Folks, it'll give you a little help, a head start on the winning season. Promo code JCE for you to claim your deposit or claim your bonus when you make your deposit at MyBookie. All the major sports and more await you. Sign up today to begin your winning season exclusively at MyBookie. No grasshopper bets.
I should say not.
I got an email here I just wanted to read real quick from, where is it? There it is. Sean sent this missive in, and he asks some very valid questions and makes a statement here. I thought we would air, you know, we try to give all sides and all opinions on the program here. Hi, Mr. Cornette. I sent the following to Brian as a drive-through question, but I wanted to forward it to you as well since I'm not from the esteemable Starkville, Mississippi. I haven't watched that AEW shit show past the first episode when I saw the direction they were headed, straight into the toilet, So my frame of reference is based solely on what you guys discuss and the stupefying displays of incompetence and buffoonery I see on Botchamania every month or so. Am I to understand that Sunny Kiss is a woman now, or has that always been the case? Either way, my very simple question is, then why isn't she competing in the AEW women's division? What is the criteria? I don't particularly care who Sunny Kiss or anyone else wants to be or who they want to bang, but in this very serious wins and losses matter sports-based presentation clusterfuck, they very clearly divide competitors between male and female, so what's going on here? Is TNT okay showing intergender fights on their network? Also, see, these are points that have to be raised in today's modern society. Also, as an aside, if Chris Jericho wants to take his Hall of Famer-level career and completely piss all over it by partaking and even leading the way with some of the most childishly ridiculous, patently phony, carny mojo bullshit, it's his own comedy bus to drive off a cliff. But, see, this is another socially conscious point we're making here. But for helping host a super spreader event that has real consequences in human lives when our country has been led into doom and disaster by the most corrupt, fascist piece of shit president in America's history, Jericho can go sit on a flagpole and spin. He can also go fuck himself. Now stop it now. This is, we're just raising socially conscious points here. He can also go fuck himself if his flaccid, flabby physique is able to bend over that far. I'm sure he's limber enough by now from having his head so far up his ass, that caterwauling cunt waffle.
Wow.
Strong points here that need to be raised.
That email was all over the place.
Well, he had some points that needed to be raised.
You know what my favorite Jericho thing has been? Is when he told everyone that the reason he gained all this weight was for his pain. What was it? The Painmaker? For the Painmaker gimmick in Japan. That he was going to be like a Dick the Bruiser type and gain all the weight.
What?
Not that he was.
I've not heard this.
Not, yeah, oh, yeah. No, when he came back and he was really out of shape, he tried to say that it was intentional. That he came back as out of shape because that was going to be for his new gimmick. Now, the weight hasn't gone away. So I really don't know what's going on.
He's not going to Japan anymore, is he?
No.
Hadn't been lately. Well, you know what? If Chris Jericho wants to get a painting of himself the way he used to look when he was athletic, I know where he can go.
Where's that?
The folks at paintyourlife.com. Folks, if you won't be together with your family for the holidays, you can find a way now to bring you all together safely. Paint Your Life, a hand-painted compilation portrait. Whether it's one photo or a number of photos of family members, pets, places you've been on vacation, whatever. Let's say that Grandma can't come from California to visit Little Ned. Well, now you can have a painting made of Grandma and Little Ned sitting on Grandma's knee, because they can combine photos and their team of world-class artists go over the details, and they combine these pictures. Every detail is perfect. They work with you until they get it just right. And it's created from any photo. So basically, paintyourlife.com. Check them out. Work with the team of world-class artists. Order the custom-made hand-painted portrait. Takes about 3 weeks. Great holiday gift. You can put anybody together, or you can separate people. If there's somebody in a family picture that you don't want there, that has excommunicated themselves, then just send that family picture to Paint Your Life and tell them, take that no good bastard out. They can do that too, because they're world-class artists. Anyway, folks, at paintyourlife.com, there's no risk. If you don't love the final painting, your money is refunded, guaranteed. And right now, as a limited time offer, 20% off your painting, 20% off and free shipping, if you text the word DRIVE, D-R-I-V-E, to 64,000, that's DRIVE to 64,000, that's 64 with 3 zeros, but who's counting? Paint your life, celebrate the moments that matter most, or erase some poor schlub from your family history. It's your choice, folks. Speaking of erasing poor schlubs, we've had a lot of people, I won't say a lot of people, it has come up, let's put it that way. It's come up in my Twitter. It's come up on email. People have been saying, why don't you watch Impact? Why don't you review Impact? Impact has been a great program. Impact is not getting the respect they deserve. They're having a great professional wrestling show over here. Nobody notices. Nobody's talking about it. Why don't you watch Impact? And it got to the point where I had just started saying to myself, you know, it can't be any worse than what we're having to look at. Maybe we should. I like Eddie Edwards. He's over there. Probably the only name I can think of off the top of my head that I like over there, that I know over there. Maybe we should do this. And I was going to, Brian, I was going to bring this up to you, and I knew you'd shit all over it because, you know, they're in the Federal Witness Protection Program, and nobody really gives a shit either way. But I figured with these few people bringing this up that I would at least give it a try and see what we had to say. There is now an impact rule here on the program. Did you hear what they done? Did you hear what they done on the TV?
I heard about it. I saw a clip. And for the record, I always get confused whether Impact is wrestling purgatory or wrestling's halfway house. But it's just filled with undesirables doing stupid shit every time I see a clip of it.
It's a halfway house for people that don't want to go all the way, apparently. They killed somebody. They murdered somebody. It's a murder mystery. Folks, if the All Friends program over on TNT Drama is a lot of high school drama, Impact has decided to counter-program this by having one of those murder mystery dinner theater things. I get what they've done. I guess they send you out a coupon for a box of Pop-Tarts, and you get your Pop-Tarts and you heat them up in the toaster, and then you watch them do the play as you eat your Pop-Tart dinner. The murder mystery unfolds in front of you. They were having a wedding. See that right there? As soon as you hear those words, you know this is not going to end well. They were having a wedding. The lights go out. The lights come back on. And the groom, who I've never heard of before, I can't remember his name now, is laying, while the lights were out, a shot rang out. And it was actually a goddamn sound effect gunshot from like a fucking local TV show or something. And then the lights come back on, and there's the groom laying there. His white suit is stained with his blood because somebody shot him. And Tommy Dreamer, you just made the list, pal. I'm sorry. I can't excuse this in any way, shape, or form. Tommy Dreamer's another one of these guys that loves the wrestling business so much, he'll just go along with anything that the kids want to do. And he's kneeling over the body screaming, "Oh, my God, they've shot whatever the fuck this guy's name is." And that's how the program went off the air. And that is how that the impact this. I saw this on Twitter. It was a short enough clip. They could put it on Twitter. And that's how the impact rule came to be. And the impact rule is I will never, ever watch anything that that company produces ever, ever.
I've had a Tommy Dreamer rule in effect for maybe 20 years.
He's such a nice guy.
That's the only thing anyone could say to ever excuse any of his crap. Because everything he does is stupid. It's stupid personified. If there's something really happening that's crappy, more than likely he's in the middle of it. Every time any promotion brings him back because he's one of the last vestiges of ECW.
Thank God for that, by the way.
I groan. Every time I see him, I groan. I go, oh no, not him again. Awful. He may be the best case for someone. You want to talk about the Paul Heyman Kool-Aid or the Paul Heyman masked hypnosis of the audience? Tommy Dreamer getting over to the extent he did is the biggest case of that. Never could do a promo, was never good in the ring, had to do the garbage wrestling because he wasn't good in the ring. And now since that time, he's just done every stupid thing imaginable.
Before I saw this clip, I would have thrown in, but he worked his ass off and beat his body up. He was ill-served by having Paulie as a mentor and an influence.
But he couldn't have gotten over without doing that stuff.
Well, but
that's
anyway.
My, that's my point. If you'd brought him to Smoky Mountain, he wouldn't have gotten over at that point as a babyface. I used to watch him in IWCCW. No. I know what he was before Paul got a hold of him.
He wouldn't have got over as a heel either in Knoxville because nobody would have understood what the fuck was going on if he did that ECW shit down there. But anyway, but he's a nice guy, damn it.
So he's got that going for him.
Got that going for him. I continue to be disappointed in everybody I've ever known. I'll just bring this up here just right now since we're talking about being disappointed in people. Now, Jericho's not the only one that contributed to Donald Trump. The Undertaker is on Twitter, contributed to Donald Trump.
That's less surprising than Jericho.
But just people that you've liked and admired or were fans of or thought were normal. And then you hear this and you can never look at those people the same way again. So the impact, as a matter of fact, the impact rule kind of leads into this other email. And what you just said about Mr. Dreamer, who's apparently dreaming. Nick, whose last name I cannot pronounce, writes, "Dear Jim, as you have been discussing the longevity of wrestlers in the territories and contrasting that with the high spot monkeys in AEW, well, he says AEW, but all the high spot monkeys everywhere. It's just the most noted zoo. This got me to thinking about the owners of promotions and their respective backgrounds. Do you think that the safety of the work in the ring has any correlation to ownership having been one of the boys? To put it another way, if Tony Khan were superplexed off the balcony of an arena into a flaming table covered with broken glass and then thrown into a body bag filled with poisonous snakes, would he be willing to allow his wrestlers to do potentially career-ending moves for no reason?" Well, yes, probably, because I'm sure Tony Khan would have got a thrill out of all of that, because they're all marks. But here, in all seriousness, as an answer to this question, the very reason why that wrestling boomed, especially in the territories, but for so many years, was because the wrestlers, yes, were in charge of the companies, were mostly ex-wrestlers, or there was a heavy... If the promoter wasn't Sam Muchnick, Jim Crockett, his booker was, right? There was a heavy veteran wrestling influence. And the thing they knew, and it was a fact, was that the ridiculous death-defying qualities of bumps or moves or whatever had no place in matches unless it was the climactic point, and even then a calculated risk, and the believability of the match and whether the people supported the babyface and were mad at the heel, those things were all way more important. You would always have guys, Ray Stevens, Chris Colt, the fucking lunatic bumpers, and most of the lunatic bumpers in those days got away with it because they were taking the bumps, not giving them. So they weren't fucking giving a guy a bump that he didn't want to fucking take or have any reason to feel like taking. They were taking them themselves, and those crazy bumpers, for whatever reason, those bumps they took because they could take those bumps without really getting hurt. I mean, it's cumulative, yes, but injuring themselves right there. How many times did you see Terry Funk just suddenly get fucking popped and just collapse backwards through the ropes and fall straight out of the ring on his fucking head on the concrete, it looked like? Because that was a bump he could take, so he took it all the time. Somebody else trying that would have broke their fucking neck. But, so, yes, the ownership played a part because the people in control were veterans of the wrestling industry and knew, don't go too far. They remember the famous story when Roy Shire came in, told Pat Patterson and Ray Stevens after they had the greatest tag team match ever seen in San Francisco, don't ever fucking do that again, you fucking idiots. You guys are going to be gone in 6 months. I got to promote this town for the next 10 years. Nobody can follow that shit. For self-preservation, for good of the business, it wasn't just trying to keep people down. If you were doing an angle with your top babyface where he had gotten a certain move or a certain thing done to him and was hospitalized and was going to come back and get revenge. And you were going to draw big money off of it. You didn't want a guy in a third match taking the same fucking bump. It was all about business and prolonging everybody's ability to be in it for both themselves and others, and for the company. But now, even if it's a veteran wrestler, as we just did Tommy Dreamer, if it's the category of veteran wrestler and he's out there doing dinner theater murder mysteries. And we've got, we'll talk about it on the brief AEW review that we do later on, but you've got Dusty Rhodes' son doing a superplex off the top rope into fucking 15 people that are going to catch him. I still say, you know what? These motherfuckers coming off the top rope, I'm walking away. Because there's a lot of knees, elbows, heads, and hard bones coming at a high rate of speed. And that's not even taken into account when you're in the middle of 10 guys reaching up to catch somebody. You got a lot of fucking arms and elbows up over your face. And these constant fucking dives for no reason other than to do them that nobody's going to remember the next day, and except when they see the clip on Twitter or somebody reminds them about it. The next week it's completely gone because they're doing something else. Somebody's going to get their fucking face reconstructed surgically off of just catching one of these idiots. So anyway, the way it was in the old days in wrestling, yes. The way it is now, the boys are the bigger fucking infringers on the standard rule of wrestling, which is make it look good, don't make it real. This stuff doesn't look good and it's real at the same time. You can't fucking defy gravity. Gravity is a harsh mistress. So as a promoter, yeah, I didn't ask people to do things that I either hadn't done or wouldn't do if I could. I never did a fucking drop kick, right? But there's, you know, you get the flavor. And if somebody wanted to do something, there's many, Chris Candido talked me into doing a couple of things that I didn't think he should do and didn't encourage him to do. Jericho didn't consult with me before he did one thing that he really shouldn't have fucking done. Cost him a lot of fucking pain and money. And there that's the thing. Today's guys, they don't have any restraint, and they have fallen into this pattern of this is what we have to do now. So if they were running the company, which in effect they are down there in Dixie Con land, they won't do anything because they're marks to they're bigger marks than the people sitting in the seats. So I don't know what to tell you now. That used to be what contained a lot of these guys and taught them how to do things the right way. Now that's no longer the case. So no, I don't think it matters if the boys are ownership or just talent. They're still going to do all this stupid shit because the conductor has decided to let the orchestra tell him what they're going to fucking play.
In terms of things that a promoter would ask a guy to do, that's one of the things people have said about Vince, is that Vince, I mean, we've seen it. He'll demonstrate what he wants you to do, even if it's something you're scared to do. Like Rob Gronkowski falling off that overhang. Here's old man Vince out of his mind doing it. Shawn Michaels doing the entrance at WrestleMania 12. There's Vince McMahon doing it. I mean, that is one thing you could say about Vince. He has done these things that he wants other guys to do.
Well, here, I'll give you one. I promoted one scaffold match in my life. Promoted one. I was in one, but I promoted one in Smoky Mountain Wrestling between Al Snow and Ricky Morton. And they talked me into it. They first came, what about a scaffold match? I think it was Al at first said it, but he'd been talking to Ricky. I said, are you out of your fucking mind? No. Well, you did it. I said, I ain't going to pay you fucking 10 grand to do it. But it was, they had done that thing, and it was Al Snow and Unabom, Glenn Jacobs, against Ricky and Robert, and they'd done the thing where Al had hit Ricky with three pile drivers in Johnson City, and we called the ambulance. And the people were, guys were waiting for Al out back of the building. The girls were crying. Ricky's girlfriend, Andrea, was in there fucking holding his hand, and his arm was quivering. And so they were going to have a single match blow off at the Volunteer Slam 95, I believe, in Knoxville. scaffold match. And oh, come on. No, they wanted to do it. Al was going to take the bump, and Ricky said he could do it safe. So I let them talk me into doing that against my better judgment. And it did draw pretty decently for our May show, which was never a huge one. But, you know, every once in a while, but you have to, for the most part, the boys, out of wanting to do good, get over, draw a house, get attention, all the right reasons, will want to do the wrong things. And those things should be discouraged. And the first thing I would do, and I'm glad, and I know all the AEW fans are going, well, I'm so glad he's not in charge. The first thing I'd do is the next motherfucker that does a dive out of the ring until I tell you to is fired. Figure out how to fucking work and see if you can come up with something else to do besides the thing that everybody is doing. But they don't listen anymore.
No, this is the era of the singer-songwriter. They don't listen. They tell you what they're going to do.
When you go to the restaurant and they just say, I'll tell you what you're going to eat.
That's what it is. Tony Khan's sitting at the table, and these guys are all serving him whatever they feel like cooking him. And he likes it.
Should we tell the people what we're going to serve them next week?
I guess we must.
I think we should. The drive-through next week will be on Tuesday once again because this weekend is my anniversary, and I have other business commitments. So we are going to record Monday and air Tuesday, and the following week's drive-through will be back on the regular schedule. That will come out on Monday, November 9th, and I got a memo from Kippelman, your butler.
He's not my butler. He says, don't call him that.
He is buttling for you. That's what I heard, that you were looking for a man's man.
What?
A gentleman's gentleman.
He's a fine gentleman, but Lou Kippelman, one of the fine producers on the Arcadian Vanguard Podcast Network. We have Lou. We have Jace Nakarado. Not a butler. He's a fine
Now, wait
man.
A minute. Now, wait a minute. That's the baby oil guy.
What?
Jace, knock it to fuck off.
No. I was wondering where you were going there. No, Jace Nakarado.
Well, he can knock it around all he wants. But anyway, Kippelman sent the memo out that we are going to have to review the AEW Full Gear pay-per-view on the drive-through 2 weeks that airs on November 9th. Is this what we're doing?
I believe this is what we're doing. I didn't receive a memo, even though Lou works for Arcadian Vanguard. I don't know how it got to you, but we are doing it, and I must admit, and I'm sure we'll talk about it a little bit more later on, I am looking forward to this pay-per-view.
Why?
I want to see what's going to happen. I'm curious how FTR and the Young Bucks will be as a match. I am curious how Adam Page and Omega will be as a match. I don't want to see MJF and Jericho. I can't lie about that. But those two matches I do want to see.
Yeah, well, we'll talk about that a little bit more upcoming, but that's our programming schedule. Next week on The Experience, we're going to be out at the normal time. We're not changing that, right?
The Experience? No, I think that's...
Yes. What we talk about, anyone knows. But I tell you, here's the thing. If we've got to review this substandard dinner theater pay-per-view, they got to do something about their audio. I'm not hearing them clearly. I wish there was some way that I could just take speakers and put them right into my ears.
There is a way.
I could hear things and I could block out the outside world and I could hear things as clear as a bell, as clear as a bell ringing over a calm lake. Is there a way, you say?
There is, in fact, a way. In fact, I have heard from these fine people that you're about to mention that they received a large order just recently from someone named Jacksonville Dixie, who ordered a bunch for his friends and family so they don't have to hear Jim Cornette's brutal critiques of his substandard dinner theater product.
There you go. He got them for all the talent because they're not listening to anybody that's calling these spots anyway. They're just doing their own shit. Folks, the Raycon Everyday E25 earbuds are exceptional. As a matter of fact, Stace panicked. She freaked out the other day because she couldn't find her earbuds. She went into an anxiety attack because she couldn't get that clean, crisp sound, the 6 hours of playtime, the seamless Bluetooth pairing. I haven't even been able to find one of her teeth that's blue, but yet she has paired it every time she gets these everyday E25 earbuds in her hot little hand. More bass, and once again, everybody always knows you need more seafood in your diet. A more compact design, noise isolating. You stick these in your ears, folks, do not cross the railroad tracks because you could be in trouble. You won't hear a train coming. And when you give them a try, Raycon has a 45-day free return policy so you can make sure they're the pair of wireless earbuds for you. You can talk on a phone. You can listen to music. You can do whatever you want to do in your own head, courtesy of the Raycon earbuds. And folks, right now, you can get 15% off. BuyRaycon.com. That's BuyRayCon. BuyRaycon.com/JCE. Because that way they know that you know us and we get you the 15% off. Raycon, everyday E25s or anything on a site. Holy mackerel. 15% off. Check it out now while the deal's still running. BuyRaycon.com/JCE. I still wish there was a less violent way of saying that, /JCE.
That's another thing a lot of the people that Jacksonville Dixie bought his Raycon headphones for, or earbuds, they close their eyes and they think about slashing JCE.
You know, that still, to me, is probably the crowning achievement of my professional wrestling career, that right now, if they were able to sell tickets and draw a crowd in the middle of the pandemic, that I could walk into an AEW arena and immediately spontaneously combust and catch on fire, and not a single one of those sorry sacks of shit would spit on me to put me out. That's possibly my fucking greatest achievement.
Well, the funny thing is, there are several sacks of shit that would spit on you to put you out, but they just don't want anyone else to know about it.
Well, and then some of them would probably want to put me out so they could set me on fire again. Anyway, what are you doing this week on your programs?
I'm going to make this kind of quick this week. I want you to check out all the fine programming on the Arcadian Vanguard Podcast Network. Of course, get information about all shows on Twitter, at Superpodcast, or on Facebook, facebook.com/Arcadian Vanguard. You could find all of these shows wherever you find your favorite podcast. But today, if you love classic wrestling, if you love honest wrestling history, check out Ron Fuller's Studcast, Breaking Kayfabe with Baldrin and Barry, Charting the Territories, Stick to Wrestling with John McAdam, the Mid-South Wrestling Television Review Podcast, the Mid-Atlantic Championship Podcast, and of course, John Arezzi's Pro Wrestling Spotlight, then and now, all shows available wherever you find your favorite podcast, and information about all shows available on Twitter and on Facebook. Also, don't forget the brand new Wrestling News Archive Twitter account, at Wrestling News AV. We are also on Facebook. Classic photos and articles and correspondence and Jerry Lawler artwork from the archives of Wrestling News, which of course encapsulates Ring Wrestling and Wrestling Review and Wrestling Monthly and all the programs for the WWF and the NWA and various places throughout the years. We post lots of different stuff on Twitter and on Facebook. If you love wrestling history, check it out today with a lot more to come in 2021. And don't forget the 605 Super Podcast, the mothership. It's been so long since we've heard your weeping during that it sounds a little different. I don't think
I'm weeping. I didn't weep before. I've tried to hedge you off at the past with a sonic block.
I missed that. There we go. Nostalgia, always in play here on the Jim Cornette Experience. But the new episode in production right now, go through the archive today, as so many of you have been doing. 605pod.com, available wherever you find your favorite podcast, the 605 Super Podcast, the mothership!
Yeah.
The Wednesday Night Wars. Now, I actually don't know exactly what you watched this week.
Well, wasn't much. But enough. Okay, first off, I wasn't going to watch any of what they present as allegedly pro wrestling on Wednesday when I heard this news that we've talked about. And then that felt so good that I didn't watch any of it on Thursday either. But I did read some of the recaps, and I saw that there were zombies on NXT, so I just decided to invoke the zombie rule. Fuck them entirely. There were actual zombies on the program? Is this what you heard?
I didn't watch it. Once you gave me a little bit of a whiff that you were thinking about not watching it, I used that as an excuse not to watch it.
Okay.
I do have it on my DVR, though, because I am curious.
This is the week they won the ratings.
This is the week they won the ratings. With everyone doing the worst possible television they could do within a couple weeks, AEW and their dinner theater, Impact having a shooting on the air, full-out drama breaking out on WWE Hell in the Cell, I am curious how NXT will deal with the latest trend in wrestling, which is really, really bad TV. So I do want to see how they handled it with Halloween Havoc and Shitzy Blitzy and her spin the wheel, make a deal. I got to watch it.
Well, I think I'd rather just bid on some of her poop.
That's $5, mister.
I can afford it. I can even get some to take home in a doggy bag. But anyway, so I didn't watch NXT because of the zombies. But they won in the ratings this week, and that is most probably a result of the dinner theater segment last week, which was blistered even by a lot of people that normally make excuses. Not all the people that normally make excuses, just some of them. But I didn't want to watch AEW either, but I had seen or heard about a couple of things that I had to just get a taste of. So this ain't going to take long, because what I did was I started watching things until there was an excuse to just say, why the fuck am I watching this? Because I'm a normal adult human being with a brain. So that didn't take too long in each segment. So we can go down them real quick. I watched two matches in their entirety, though, so we can talk about that. And I didn't write a lot of stuff down. Here's what I wrote. The opening match was Wardlow versus Page. Here's what I wrote down. Nothing. They had a match, and they're two of the best-looking athletes they've got on the roster. And then they got up on the top rope and did the thing where Adam Page has to crawl up on the guy's shoulders, and I said, oh, fuck it. What'd you think?
I thought it was all right. Probably the best thing on the show.
Well, no, it wasn't.
Well, one of the best. You're right. One of the best things on the show.
One of the least good things.
I like the finish.
Or one of the least bad things on the show.
I like the finish because the finish kept Wardlow kind of strong, but it also got Adam Page over. I did want to ask you, this tournament for the number one contender to the AEW title.
Yes.
It so far has been booked kind of predictable. Or I guess we could have predicted the way they were booking this thing. I think we kind of did, actually. Is there anything wrong with that as a booker? Is there anything wrong with having a tournament where the average viewer can predict exactly where it's going?
No, that's a good thing. Because then that means they want to see the fucking final match that you've got, that you're going to give them. So many people have started to book to surprise people. Well, Shitstain started that. This will be a surprise. Here's the thing. Yeah, if we told the kids Christmas was coming for 6 weeks and then the fucking day of Christmas, you know what? They canceled it. That'd be a surprise. But you're not giving the people what they want to see. Sometimes it's obvious if you have two guys, and I'm not saying these are the two guys. I don't think fucking Kenny Olivier could draw money if you dipped him in glue and drug him through Fort Knox. Page can, but he's, you know, been booked to be a drunk and a fucking whatever the fuck. In the middle of this, I don't know what can make any difference. But
A sad drunk.
But in a normal situation, it's not that bad if the people can predict the final of an 8-man tournament, because that's probably the match they want to see to begin with in the finals, or a program between these two guys over the title or whatever. So just the people being able to predict it is not necessarily. Now, when they can predict it and they also don't want to see it, now that's a problem. But when it's something that you don't just take away what people want to see because you want to surprise them, someday you juice it up, you maybe add some good to it, but you should be going in the direction of what you think they'd want to see to begin with. I don't know why any of these people want to see this fucking Twinkle Toes McFinger bang, as we'll get to in a minute. But yeah, so Page hit him with his clothesline and he went to a knee and then he hit him with another one and beat him. But Wardlow's been bungled since day one.
I don't disagree with you there, but to the earlier point, this is exactly where we thought they were going. Page versus Omega. The buildup from them being a team and then breaking up as a team has been really, really poor. But, like I said earlier,
that's because they didn't make people care about these two guys individually to begin with. They think they did, but they didn't. Not anybody that didn't already care, as is evidenced by their ratings. It's the same fucking people. So they've been following along this dramatic horseshit storyline of their conflicted emotions of the team and Paige's lack of responsibility and Olivier's lack of wanting to confront some, whatever the fuck. And to most normal people and any excommunicated wrestling fans, they're just a bunch of, just like the Young Bucks and the rest of these idiots, just a bunch of fucking nitwits whining and bitching over silly shit. So, say if Wardlow had come in and was an unstoppable monster and was fucking MJF's bodyguard for a year, being figured into the program on every week's show and fucking doing things to help MJF, and then suddenly, and MJF bullies him, but then suddenly the worm turns and Wardlow turns on MJF, as is probably what's going to happen sometime. That might mean something. And if Wardlow had destroyed a bunch of people and been an unstoppable monster in a variety of appearances, that would mean something. But they just start out like everybody's over. They do these things for a week or two. Then you don't see people for a while, and then they come back to it. That was Wardlow and Page. I'm done with that fucking thing, because we have to move on to the Young Bucks at FTR interview segment with Excrement, providing his local cable access level analysis and interview skills. Matt Massey, a.k.a. Buck Hogan, did he take the Stanislavski method acting class in his high school drama? He's wringing running his hands through his hair, and he's making faces, and he's wringing his hands and clutching his pearls over the, and some fucking guy, well, no, I was about to say some guy working at a gas station in Des Moines is going, who is this little fucking dweeb? But nobody working at a gas station in Des Moines is watching this program, because it's full of small children anguishing over their fucking hurt feelings over their broken video games and their interrupted masturbatory sessions at home in the basement. So they basically have made FTR the adults with his constant whining about, oh, we had lost something. Yeah, the fucking genetic lottery to be taken as badasses. That's what you lost, you fucking little middle school nerds. Anyway, so FTR walks off, and Excrement he had something at one point. Oh, yeah, later on, and he was questioning Olivier's cardio conditioning. He said, well, Olivier has primarily been a tag team wrestler, so is his cardio as good as Penta El Zorro? Yeah, because Penta El Zorro is a member of the fucking Lucha Brothers. He's a tag team guy, too, you fucking idiot. Your whole goddamn point made no sense. Anyway, see, that's why I didn't watch this whole thing.
This segment was so bad. I've been saying it for a while, but even some of the AEW fans are starting to pick up on it. The Young Bucks are horrible promos. Matt Jackson specifically. Because Nick just sits back and waits for a line to throw in. Matt Jackson, he's a bad promo. He's a bad actor. There's nothing believable about them. None of this makes any sense. Why all of a sudden they started acting like heels? Why all of a sudden the stipulation is, if we don't win the match, we'll never get a title shot ever again?
Oh, yeah. Now that, and it, so are they going to do what Cody did? And then they're going to make a title that they can wear that it's not the title that they can't challenge for anymore? Or are they actually going to beat FTR in the first match and kill the whole thing deader than fucking 4 o'clock? What? Which avenue are they going to take there?
I would bet on the latter if I was going to my bookie and doing some AEW gambling.
Well, but who knows? But Buck Hogan has a injured body part.
His brain.
So the fucking yeah. Well, besides that, I no injured, not fucking warped. So they've managed to become heels over the last several weeks, whiny, bitchy heels that attack the announcers and fucking complain and whine about everything so that they can fight the heel team that has the belts with the heel manager that come off as the baby faces. And now one guy's hurt. If they beat FTR and the guy's got a hurt leg, then can we just say the executive vice presidents are going to get their way regardless of what's good for business and move on?
Have you seen the cover of their upcoming book?
Thankfully, no.
I don't know who designed it or why they designed it this way, but it just looks like they're staring at each other's dicks. They're both just like shirtless looking down at each other's dicks. I saw it the other day because John Arezzi, they put on presale his upcoming book, which comes out in like April of 2021, and it beat them. It was the number one best-selling wrestler biography, even though it's presale. I think the chart goes up and down, but he had beat them the other day. He also beat Abraham Lincoln. And I saw the Bucks book. I was like, it looks...
Yeah, but who'd Abraham Lincoln ever beat?
It looks like some weird romance novel. What is this? Who designed this book? Who signed off on this and thought it was a good idea?
Harlequin.
And then I remembered it was the Bucks, actually.
It's a Harlequin romance. They have to be in love with somebody, so they're in love with each other. No, here, the next thing, well, I don't know, because I just jotted some things down from memory, so I don't even know if this was in order, but the best thing on the show, a wrestling match suddenly broke out. Serena Deeb and Layla, her opponent, what was her name? Layla Hirsch?
Hirsch.
Every man on the roster should be ashamed. Serena Deeb is the best all-around worker in AEW. Which is not surprising. She was trained by Rip Rogers. But every time she gets it, you could, from the time she locks up, the level of professionalism, her basics are there. She was a trainer for quite some time. The basics are there. The match makes sense. She's serious about it, works hard. This other girl hadn't seen Herb. They said she had an amateur background. I believed it. Every man on this roster should be ashamed of themselves. They actually ought to have Serena teaching their training class, which every single member of the roster should be enrolled in. I thought it was an excellent... It was the only real wrestling match on the program.
I thought it was really good. I was impressed by Layla Hirsch. And Serena Deeb has had like a career revival, and I think a lot of people are noticing her. They gave her the NWA title. Yeah. Obviously, they taped this in advance, so I guess she came out with the belt here before her winning the title aired. But she beat Thunder Rosa.
Well, and the thing is, when you look at it, Serena's always been that good. And it's just that now they have had, as we've talked about, the worst women's division with the worst workers in it of any major league wrestling company ever in history. It stunk. So all of a sudden, somebody comes in that's really good and looks fantastic after what's come before. So immediately, yeah, we're going to sign her. They should have signed her to begin with. They should have her training all the women. Anyway, hopefully she will still be getting pushed like this when Riho is able to travel again. That's the problem, is they shot themselves in the foot with their women's division because they let a fucking idiot determine who was going to be the roster of the women's division and book it, who had absolutely no idea how to even fucking take care of himself, much less other people, and shot the whole thing to shit for a year without getting any qualified fucking talent in that division.
Serena Deeb has looked awesome since she came in. They had her do a job to Big Swole, who may be the single worst women's wrestler in the entire business.
In the entire world. And that's because when they'd first brought her in, they were just doing a favor with the, you know, for the NWA crossover and didn't have any thought to when she had that great match. Oh, well, we've also got her booked for this. That's because there's no thought. they just do this shit based on somebody having an idea. I never, ever, in any of the promotions I was involved in, exposed someone on television as anything other than the role that they were going to be involved in. In other words, it's not like I said, oh, well, let's put this guy on TV, and if he does good, I'll push him. Well, then you've just beat the guy you might push. Put him in a dark match. Don't tape it to see how the people react to him. Never put someone on television unless you know exactly what you're going to do with them going forward. Anyway, did you see the brawl back in the backstage area between the Chuckle Fucks and Pip and his friend Miro? See, we got Riho. Now we're going to have Miro because he's not manly enough for me to actually pronounce his name with bass in my voice. But did you see that brawl? Did you get where I believe it was Pip? It wasn't even the big Bulgarian brute, but Pip grabbed Chucklefuck Taylor, didn't even grab him, just laid his hand on the back of Chucklefuck's head and pointed in a direction, and Chucklefuck flew 15 feet through the air at a flip over a table.
Yep, I saw.
And Stacy was coming through to take Harley out to piss, and I said, watch this, and I backed it up, and she was dying laughing. She's been enough wrestling school classes to fucking know these guys don't know what they're doing. She sat there and watched for a minute and then shook her head and went out to watch the dog piss because it was more entertaining. Moving along quickly, Pockets and Cody. I was not in the mood in the light of the week's events to watch the son of Dusty Rhodes dignify this piece of shit with working with him. So I fast forwarded through this, but I had to see the spot they put out on Twitter, like they were proud of it. They put shit out on Twitter that I would burn the video of if it was my program, and they're proud of it. Cody gives Pockets a superplex off the top rope out to the floor where, what was it, 12, 14 people were waiting to catch him?
Yep.
For what? For why?
Why is there a lumberjack match?
Yeah, because everybody in the previous match they had tried to bail out and run away.
Didn't they say they were doing a lumberjack match to prevent the Dark Order from interfering? And then they made the Dark Order lumberjacks?
At ringside as lumberjacks.
Fantastic booking.
You've got a guy that has a list of gimmick matches that he likes. And now that he's getting to play Booker, we'll make this a lumberjack match, even though there's no reason for it to be. Nobody tried to leave the ring in the previous contest between the two of these people. If you want people not to be able to interfere, a lumberjack match is not the one you have, because a lumberjack match is not to keep people out. It's to keep you in. The cage match is to keep people out, but they don't do that anymore either. So 15 people waited for, and as a matter of fact, she was watching this too, because they came right one in front of the other. And they're all standing there waiting to catch the, yeah, boom. And she shook her head and went back the other way. It's just stupid. So I didn't see any of this match. Was there any other highlight or low light that I should be aware of? I don't care.
I didn't care either. Cody's entrance is just preposterous. It's like the Messiah has landed.
We ain't got to the preposterous entrance yet. It puts new posture in the meaning of preposterous. But first, we had the town hall. So in the middle of this alleged wrestling program, Saturday Night Live breaks out. I don't know how much time this took, because MJF and Chris Jericho in a town hall where they're going to be asked questions. Obviously a fucking ripoff or a parody or whatever of the town hall presidential debate. But in this case, MJF is making the case, if I got this correctly, MJF is making the case of how he could be a benefit to the inner circle if he was a member, right? How can he benefit the heel group? The first question that was asked, and I can't even believe I'm dignifying this horseshit enough to go along with this scenario this far, but the first question that was asked was from Dino Douche. This premise is ridiculous enough to begin with, and then you have baby faces asking a heel questions about how he can benefit the heel group. And then this complete dipshit under this dinosaur mask. It was funny maybe the first time, 65 million years. Now, and our first question is from a man from 65 million BC. As a member of the dinosaur lobby, you know what? You're a big piece of shit. Here's what you are, Dino. You're a big piece of fucking awkward shit. You move around the ring like a cow on fucking ice. You try to flip around like a gymnast, which is not the way you should be working, but actually you shouldn't be working because you're not very fucking good at it. Now that we've got that out of the way, as soon as this fucking dipshit asked that question, I've already written MJF off. The pods have taken him. He was the only bright spot they had. The pods have taken him. They've taken over his body. He's now one of these pod people that wants to do musical comedy and Saturday Night Live sketches. So I've given up on that. The dino asked the question, and I fast-forwarded.
It's not musical comedy and Saturday Night Live. It's worse. It's Monday Night Raw.
It's even more low budget than that. But to show you how it's more low budget than that, it's actually more like, what was their show on Thunder? Thursday Thunder. It's WCW Thunder. Because as I'm zipping through and I was going to the end, I see an old gray-haired man. And I said, it can't be. And I stopped. It was. It's Eric Bischoff. And Eric Bischoff is on there asking a question in the town hall. If Eric is so hard up that he's got to travel in a pandemic at his age, he's older than me, to take a payoff just because the owner of the company is a mark for the company that Eric ran into the ground 20 years ago, it's still sad to see that. I could give him some tips on podcasting and merchandise and how to make an income without having to prostitute himself like this. But then again, you got to have something that people want to hear or something that people want to buy, which is maybe why he's out here prostituting himself on a Marx television program, asking stupid questions in a goddamn cable access skit. Maybe that's it. I don't know. Anyway, anything else happened there? Because I skipped it.
No, it was terrible. It was just from the intro of Shivani and Dasha introducing themselves like it's a real town hall. Just the goofiness of it. MJF has become a massive disappointment in the last several months. Chris Jericho's 2020 is a complete waste of time. I don't want to see this match. At this point, I don't really want to see these people on my fucking TV. I will say I like the promo MJF did earlier in the show with him and Wardlow before the Wardlow match when MJF and Sammy Guevara had a bit of a confrontation. That was good. But everything else he does, look, very talented guy, but wrestling doesn't need to be a talent show where you show every single thing you could do each and every time you're out there. This stuff is awful.
You know what? One of the girls needs to come out tap dancing. Like in the little junior Miss pageant.
Brandy.
No, Olivier, because he was next. And that's exactly what he did. He came out tap dancing. Jesus, tap dancing Christ. The main event of this show was Kenny Olivier against Penta Osolomio. And I was going to zip ahead because I figured this would be the same as every other Kenny Olivier match. I started watching that entrance, and the only thing I could think was they have actually spent money on this. And after the graphics and the big buildup, the introduction by George Hamilton IV and the dancing girls with the brooms and the lucha masks, they've spent money on this. They've spent money on the graphics. They've given it the big buildup. They've hired these two twats to come out and embarrass themselves with brooms. And out walks a guy in a fucking t-shirt. And walks under the brooms. And if there are 350 million people in this country, if they were all forced to watch it, every single one besides the 750,000 that watch this show every week are saying, what in the flying French fried titty fuck is this guy doing? What's his deal? Why are the girls out there with brooms, and what the fuck is this that we're looking at? In other words, every normal human being. And did you tell me? Anyway, I watched this match. By the way, I'll tell you this, and I'll ask you this question. I watched this match because I wasn't going to, but the first move of the match was so insulting and amateurish, I got to watch this. Olivier grabs a headlock. Penta Solo Mio Mayo down on the bio, backs up into the ropes, takes one step out and shoots him off. That's a pun intended. Took one step and Olivier runs 100 miles an hour all the way to the other side of the ring. Instantly, the first fucking move of the match is an expose. Not only exposes the business as being phony, but also exposes Olivier as being kicked out of every wrestling school and or developmental program he's ever been in. And Penta's doing lucha. And that's what they do. So this was hot garbage from the get-go. And am I to understand, this is the question I'm going to ask you now, is Olivier now, we are supposed to be taking him as a heel? He's the old Kenny Olivier is back. The best, greatest wrestling artist in the world. He's a heel now. We're going to see what he's all about.
I think he's clearly a heel, although obviously one of the big things that AEW, specifically Cody, has said is that AEW doesn't have any of these boring old wrestling tropes like heels and babyfaces. Everyone is just a person with various complexities. With that said, I think he's clearly a heel.
Well, I got news. Cody may be right, because there is absolutely no difference in Kenny Olivier's work, whether he's a babyface or a heel, except he makes more faces, more funny, awkward faces, and does more gesticulating and finger-pointing when he's a heel than he does when he's a babyface, but the match is exactly the same. He does moves. He doesn't really work like a babyface when he's a babyface. He does moves. So therefore, he doesn't work like a heel now that he's a heel. He just does moves. There's no cheating, except when he just does things that technically would be illegal, because those are things he always does, because he does moves. But was this match in any way different besides him, instead of making boo-boo faces like he normally does, he makes nasty boo-boo faces? Otherwise, was the match the same as any other match he would have ever have had?
Pretty much. Hey, I got a question. You know, a lot of guys are very defensive about their finishing maneuvers and different things they do. You know, traditionally, if someone did a DDT, they wouldn't want someone else coming into the territory or coming into the promotion and doing
right.
The DDT. Do you think if some other wrestler came in and started pointing and stuff, Kenny Omega would put his foot down and be like, wait a minute, I'm the one who points before I run. No one else is allowed to point and then run as fast as they can to the other side of the ring. You think he's defensive of that?
He probably would, because that's the biggest part of his arsenal, and that's probably something that he would notice. He hasn't yet noticed that he doesn't know how to apply holds properly or fucking do the basic fundamentals because he bypassed wrestling school. But he probably would notice if somebody was spinning around like a ballet dancer and fucking finger pointing and gesticulating, he'd notice that. They did the chop me, no chop me spot. Within minutes of the start of the match, the sock-faced fuck took 30 seconds to take his fucking glove off. I hate the chop me, no chop me to begin with. It's so stupid. And then the one thing to show he was a heel, Olivier, instead of chopping the guy back, kicks him and then starts stomping him. And I swear to God, go back now that I'm going to say this and watch after the chop me, take the glove off. When Olivier starts stomping old Penta, it looked like a ballet dancer trying to kill a cockroach. He can't punch or kick. He can flip around and do these fucking running, rolling, flippy, divey thingies. He can't fucking punch or kick. He did a dive over the top rope, sat right on Pentagon's head out on the floor. My basic summation of this match, in my experience, if you told two students in wrestling school, if you guys sell the most tickets to the show coming up on Saturday night, you can have any kind of match you want. This is the kind of match that they would have. Just fucking jacket there. I don't know. Anyway, then old Penta gave like that you actually give this move. Olivier gave it to himself, but Penta gave Olivier a Canadian destroyer, a flipping pile driver on the wooden ramp, then rolled him in the ring and gave him a package pile driver that looked pretty good and got a two count. Olivier kicked out. I said, okay, that's enough then. I fast forward to the rest of it. They went three more minutes, of course, after that, and Olivier won with the one-winged fairy, but I didn't care because he'd just gotten a super flipping pile driver on a ramp and then followed up with a fucking spike double arm fucking pile driver and got a two count, and that's enough for me. Fuck y'all. Fuck it. Especially this week. Everybody involved should be fined or suspended or horsewhipped in the public square for being an embarrassment to what used to be professional wrestling. That was my... And apparently even the viewers thought so this week because they got their ass kicked by the developmental program that apparently sucked on the other channel. Closing thoughts?
Nah, not really.
Good. Here's one thing we got to say before we go, and I'm not going to go long. I'm just going to plead with everybody. It's come down to nut cutting time. The election is this coming Tuesday. We probably won't know, unfortunately, the results for at least a week by the time they count all the mail-in ballots and et cetera. And it may look dark on election night because everybody knows the Republicans, if they had any sense, Trump wouldn't be president. We wouldn't go through this. So they're all going to vote in person in the middle of a pandemic. So it may look bad that night, but we are going to keep our fingers crossed for the ultimate final result when everything gets counted. Everything, at least, that the criminal in the White House will not get in the way of being counted. That's why we got to turn out. That's what I'm saying, folks. Vote for whatever reason you want to. Are you tired of being fucked around by this fucking guy? Are you just tired of being lied to by this fucking guy and his criminal family? Are you tired of all the reality show bullshit going on constantly? Are you tired of people dying from the pandemic? Are you tired of people's rights being taken away by the conservative judges that they're appointing? Are you tired of being embarrassed to be an American citizen in the face of the world because we put this guy in charge? Have you noticed over the past week, maybe now this has changed your mind, that he don't give a fuck about you because he's doing these rallies in the middle of a pandemic? I don't know, when you see these rallies, nobody wearing masks, everybody shoulder to shoulder, the irresponsibility, the criminality of it in a situation like this, for him to be bringing these people together, who's to blame? The people or Donald Trump? You can make a case to blame the people. If they're that stupid, if they allow themselves to be suckered by this guy and take medical advice from Donald Trump instead of the leading physicians in the world, well, then they deserve it. But they're going out and spreading it to other people that weren't there supporting the Mango Mussolini, that were in their homes trying to be good citizens. So do you feel bad for the people that go to the rallies and get sick, or do they deserve it, but then they infect other people? How about the fucking elderly people that he left in Omaha the other night after his rally? It's like the episode of South Park where they had the home jewelry shopping network, and they were taking advantage of all the senior citizens who were feeble-minded and didn't know any better. They were selling them this ridiculously overpriced costume jewelry. These old people that don't know any better, that have bought this bullshit that he sold them, that nothing's wrong and the pandemic's a Democratic hoax, and they won't talk about it on November the 4th anymore. And so they go out in these things, and not only do they risk getting sick and dying, but he froze them in Omaha. The people couldn't get back to their cars. The buses couldn't get in. People were left for hours in 9-degree weather. They had to take 20 of them to the hospital. While Trump's fat fucking orange ass is on Air Force One flying home in comfort, he doesn't give a shit about you. He's using all of you, just like his criminal family has used everybody they've come in contact with for their entire lives. They were bred and raised to do that. Read books, educate yourself, people. Yes, I'm completely astonished that everybody in the world couldn't see what this guy was from the day one, like everybody with a half of a lick of sense did. Yes, I'm calling you people that support Donald Trump stupid, because stupid is as stupid does. Now's your time to have some backbone and have some balls and make up for your mistake and make up for what you and everybody else that voted for this pig-faced piece of shit have brought on the fucking world. You can make up for it. Vote against him this time. Try to redeem yourselves. But if those people are too lost, and I think they are, because nobody could still think this guy's legitimate. They want what he's doing, and they don't care that he's a criminal, they don't care he's a liar, and they don't care how bad he's going to fuck the world up. They want to keep their guns, they want to get rid of abortion, or they want to goddamn get even with the fucking black people. That's basically what we're down to now. It's the only reason to have this criminal in charge. It's embarrassing, it's insulting, it's dangerous. People are fucking dying. And so I'm making a plea to everybody, go vote. Redeem us in the eyes of the world. 4 more years of this, none of us may be around. Because there's only so long you can go when the head of the strongest country in the world has no fucking clue what he's doing or incentive to even give a shit, as long as he stays out of prison and makes a fucking living off of all of us. And then there was something very, very, to me, ironic on Twitter. The Lincoln Project, no, it wasn't the Lincoln Project. They've done some good work, but somebody else just did a video. All the early voting, who's standing in line? Who's waiting 8 hours? The black people. You know, in a lot of these swing states, they're the ones standing in those long lines because they know what the fuck this piece of shit is, and they are tired of it, and they're sick of it, and they're not going to put up with getting shot and fucking killed and fucking thrown in jail and goddamn have the president of the United States of supporting the Nazis and the fucking white supremacists and the militia lunatics just because they're the only ones craven enough to vote for the piece of shit. So the black vote may actually save us, because as we all know, he's turned pretty much everybody against him with the things he's done except for stupid, uneducated white people. So I would like to here and now thank every black citizen of the United States of America within the sound of my voice for not saying, you know what? Fuck all these motherfuckers. What they've done to us for the past 400 years, they deserve this piece of shit. The black vote may actually save us dumb, stupid, uneducated white people from certain doom. But you don't have to be black to be fed up with this piece of shit. Just get mad. Get mad enough to, if you can't vote now by mail, it's too late. Get mad enough, if you haven't already gone, go. We cannot put up with this shit anymore. And those spineless Republican dipshits in the Senate and in the House of Representatives and any elected official, they know exactly what this fucking guy is, and they've covered it up or gone along with it or enabled it just so they can get their shit passed. They ought to be brought up for treason just as well as he should. They know, and they're too gutless to do anything about it. They put every single one of us in danger because they have no spine. Vote those cocksuckers into a fucking obscurity as well. Get mad. That's the only way we're going to do something about it. Get mad. Don't get mad like the fucking militias with their tiny penises and their major, large fucking automatic rifles. Get mad enough to go out and stand in line if you have to and vote. I got mine in a long time ago. And that's what we have to do. We're going to know in the next couple of weeks, basically, if there are more horrible, racist, stupid, gullible assholes in this country, or if there are more sane, rational, reasonable people that didn't realize that this could ever happen in the last election and are now determined to stop it. And unfortunately, we already know it's like 40-60. 40% of Americans are pretty fucking stupid. This has been the biggest IQ test in the history of America. And 40% of us passed it or flunked it. So the 60% of us, many of whom haven't taken it up until now, need to get out there and make their presence known. Because this is not just somebody else's problem. What they are doing is going to affect every single person that lives in this country and every single person that lives in this world. Because there's another thing. You know, as long as these science-denying, ass-backwards idiots are in charge, nothing will be done about global warming, climate change, whatever the fuck. Because they're too worried about the profits from the oil industry or the make sure to put the coal miners back to work. Fuck you, fucking idiots. So everybody in the world has a stake in this. The most powerful man in the world is also an idiot, a liar, a criminal, self-centered, obnoxious, refuses to learn, and is probably on some kind of fucking drugs to begin with, because who else acts that way? So everybody has a stake in this. If you're an international listener and you know somebody in America, call them up or email them and make sure they voted, unless they're going to vote for the idiot, in which case lose their fucking number and don't remind them about the election. We got to do something, people. And we're going to figure out in about 2 weeks whether this was an aberrant episode in American history, a perfect storm created this happening, but we're not really, really like that. And we can prove that to everybody. Or we can put this piece of shit in that White House another 4 years and everybody in the world is fucked and we are responsible for it. America saved the world in 1945, ended it in 2021. That'd be great. Fuck, stupid fucking white people. I hate you. Anyway, do your thing. We'll find out very shortly. We'll see what happens. I'm still saying there's more people that aren't assholes than are. It's close. But I've still got to be optimistic. I'll be that way for another couple of weeks and we'll see what happens. Have I convinced everybody by now the importance of voting?
I think so.
All right. Good. I can't even believe we have to go through this. What the what?
Well, we have to go through an election?
No, that we have to go through what I just went through explaining. I can't stand the things that the Republicans want to do. I think they're all fucking nuts and backwards and crazy, etc. Right? But having said that, this is not even about ideological viewpoints or differences of opinion. This is how can people be such shitty judges of character? How can people ignore what is standing in front of them every time he opens his mouth? You know he's an idiot. He doesn't know what he's talking about. You know he's a liar. You know he doesn't give a shit. Everything that he has done has been predicted. Just like they imagine this, COVID is spiking in the fall like the expert scientists predicted 6 months ago. But now, shockingly, it's happening. Who could have thought? Oh, all the people that predicted it, except for President Pigshit, who said it was going to be gone by Easter. I can't understand what's wrong, how a human being's mind can be warped to the point that they can look at, listen to, or see what this fucking idiot does and think he should be in charge of anything. That means that there is a serious amount of mental illness going on in the world and in this country. And we all, as people who are in control of our faculties and can sniff bullshit when it's under our nose, need to go out and make up for these people for the good of the world. Fuck, I can't believe this. It's still 40-60. What the fuck? 40% of the people in this country apparently like to have their balls nailed to a wooden step stool. Anyway, try to save the world before it's too late. It'll be too late in about 3 weeks. There you go. Otherwise than that, will you be back here next week, Brian?
I think so.
So will I.
All right.
Well, that's it then. Are we done?
We can be done.
We're done. I got to say thank you, fuck you, bye first, don't I?
That would help.
Thank you, fuck you, bye.